So hello everyone, this is Priyansh Gupta here. I welcome you to the fourth video of this revolutionary course. In this video, I'm going to talk about Python WSGI, and we are going to cover everything about this Python WSGI, that what is Python WSGI server, what is WSGI application, and then we will see about JUnicorn and Django built-in WSGI server that has been made by Django developers itself. But we will see what are the limitations of that Django built-in server, because we can't use that Django built-in server if we want to deploy our website, right? We have to switch from Django built-in server that you use while development. We have to switch from that to JUnicorn and Nginx or Apache or ModWSGI, because that built-in server is not safe from security point of view and also has some limitations regarding traffic handling. Then we will talk about these web servers like Nginx and Apache and WSGI servers like JUnicorn. So we will see how these different kinds of web servers, WSGI servers, then WSGI application actually communicate between each other. We will see that, like how a request actually get transferred from one place to another and actually handled by our backend, and the response is given back to the user. And then we will see the limitations of this WSGI server, because in next video we will see about ASGI server and Node.js server, and we will compare everything with each other. Okay, and then we will be able to see which server performs better in what scenarios, and we will compare the performance and efficiency of each server. Now, even though we are using a WSGI server, but then also we will try to add asynchronous programming at our backend in Django using async.io module of Python, and also by using async to sync and sync to async wrapper functions. Okay, we will see all that in this video. So this video is going to be a full package video, because once you have watched this video, you would have learned everything about WSGI server and how you can use async programming at backend. Okay, and you can understand about the multi-threading, how these servers are actually using multi-threading concepts to handle multiple concurrent requests at backend, and how you can actually increase your efficiency of handling tasks of database operations, IO based operation, and CPU intensive tasks by using these multi-threading and async programming at backend. And in this video, we will also see how you can add async functionality to a class-based view also, because many people use class-based views, many people use function-based views in Django. So we will see how you can also add a async functionality in a class-based view. Okay, and this video is going to be completely unique, because no one has ever covered this kind of thing till now. So now, without wasting time, let's get started. Now let's actually understand how the server works. Okay, and now it will be very easy to understand the concepts, since we have understood about networking, multi-threading, multi-processing, and all that stuff. Now what we have to understand is this thing. Till here we have understood like the whole process of this is networking. This is something that we have already understood. Now we have to understand that how, once this request is received on this server, like after a socket connection has been established between the user and server, then how will this server actually process the request, like how this web server will take the request and pass that request to the backend code that we have written and run the Python script or JavaScript script that we have written in backend, where we actually perform some logics and then generate the response using the database and rendering HTML, CSS in JavaScript, or we can generate a JSON response in a REST API. So how can we do that? In Python, like suppose if you have written the backend code in Python, then how this web server will actually run your script? Okay, how it will run? It will be able to run a python.exe file at backend, which can actually process the request. So earlier what happened was, it was not possible for the web server like Apache or Nginx to run the Python script at backend, okay, to actually process the request. So Apache came up with the solution of something called as modpython. Now this modpython, in modpython file they have written some type of code which can actually run the Python script at backend and process the request and contact the database, make some queries, and taking the response from the database, it can actually make a response and render it to
user. But this mod Python was never officially used. So then Python community finally came up with the solution of this WSGI. Now this WSGI is a standard interface that is used basically to connect a web server with your web application. So that if web server receives any request, then can actually pass, then it can actually run a Python script at backend and send the request to that Python script, and then Python script is able to handle that request and make a response. So this is the work of this WSGI. Now this WSGI consists of two parts. One is WSGI framework and another is WSGI server. In this diagram, if we see, there is a web server here, and suppose your backend is written in Python script. Okay, you are using some Python framework, or you are writing from scratch your Python script. Okay, but in Django, if you are using a Django framework, and this Django framework is basically called as WSGI application. WSGI framework or WSGI application. Now, if you want to connect this web server in WSGI framework, then you need one more entity in between, and this is known as WSGI server. Now, what happens is, as soon as you start this web server process on your system, then what happens is it will start executing its executable file .exe in Windows operating system or .out in Linux. Then what it will do is the instruction written in this web server file will be written in such a way that it will actually bind itself to a port which you have mentioned in the configuration file. Suppose you mentioned the port here, port 80. Suppose you write the port number 80 in this web server configuration file. So what it will do is it will run the executable file and then it will actually bind itself to the port number 80. Okay. And when executable file will execute, kernel will allocate a kernel thread to that, and it will start forwarding the instructions from this file to the CPU to actually execute that. So now it will bind this application to this port number 18. So it will be currently in a listening state. Okay, in listening state. And what we will do is we will link this server file in configuration file only. We will mention the WSGI server here. We will mention the WSGI server file as well. Suppose you are using Apache and mod WSGI. Let's take the example. You are using a Apache and mod WSGI for your deployment of Python website, Python backend framework website on a Linux platform. Okay, let's take the example for that. Now you start this process of web server. It will bind itself to the port number 80. And in the configuration of this mod WSGI in Apache, what you will do is you will mention the WSGI call, and this WSGI framework will contain one function that is called as callable function. Callable function, and this, and you will mention that callable function inside this. Okay, you will mention the callable function inside this configuration file. And in Django, we have a file known as WSGI.py. So we will mention that file which contains the callable function. So what it will do is, as soon as someone tries to communicate on this port or tries to make a connection on this port number, what it will do is it will invoke the callable function. It will not basically call, because already one Python process is already running on the system from this python.exe file that has been started by this mod WSGI. And Apache will basically start a process which will bind itself to the port number 18. And there will be one more Python script that is running on the system by this mod WSGI. So what it will do is, whenever someone tries to communicate on this port number 80, it will invoke one function that is a linkage between this WSGI server and this Django, which is a WSGI application. So it will invoke this callable function here, and which will act as a linkage. And now we can actually call any function of Django that we have placed in this application. Okay, so this is how it all works. But now suppose if you are using Nginx and Gunicorn, now in this what will happen is, what you will do is, you will start the application, first you will configure the Gunicorn, okay? You will start the Gunicorn process, and in Gunicorn is itself will call one Python script, okay? It will call one python.exe file which will start executing on the CPU, and what we will do is, we will bind this python.exe file itself earlier we were not binding python.exe file. The instructions in this python.exe file were not like that. But in this GUnicorn, what we will do is this python.exe file will itself bind to some port that we will mention here. So now suppose let's say we are using the port 8000. So when you will deploy your website using this GUnicorn and Nginx, you will first start your website using this GUnicorn, and you will start in Python script that itself has the instructions and the capability to bind itself to the port number 8000. And in that GUnicorn file, we will call one callable function. We'll call the callable function. Not call, we will invoke. We will invoke the callable function that is defined in the wsdi.py file of Django. Okay. So this GUnicorn will invoke that function, and this is the way we can actually handle the request and actually pass the request to the Django application. So this is how it all works. But now you will say, like, suppose if this GUnicorn itself has a capability to bind to the port number 8000, then what is the use of this Nginx? So Nginx will act as a reverse proxy here. We can also, one thing I want to tell you is that we can even deploy our website without using Nginx and with GUnicorn itself. Okay, we can deploy our website using GUnicorn itself. Okay, using a web server, using a WSGI server that is written in Python itself. But now, what is the role of this Nginx? If we deploy our website using Nginx, what we will do is we will start the process of Nginx, and we will bind this Nginx process to a port number. Suppose I bind this Nginx process to port number 80. So now it's listening on this port number 80, and GUnicorn is listening on this port number 8000. And normally when we deploy our website, so anyone who tries to communicate or make a connection, it generally requests to this port number 80. Okay, it generally requests to port number 80, right? Because it is a convention of HTTP protocol that by default it uses a port number 80. So we will bind this Nginx to port number 80, and what this Nginx will do, it will pass on the requests that are coming to this port number 80 to the port number 8000 at which this GUnicorn process is running. So basically, this Nginx will act as a reverse proxy. And instructions in Nginx is written in such a way that it is able to handle the traffic, okay, and helps in load balancing as well. So Nginx has one more point, that is load balancing. Okay, load balancing. And one more benefit of this Nginx is it will help us to serve static files. Serve static files. And static files include images, CSS, JavaScript and other files. Okay, so if we give the responsibility of serving static files to this Nginx, then our load will be distributed between this Nginx and this GUnicorn and our Python backend framework or WSGI application. So our load will now distribute between this Nginx and this GUnicorn. So we are reducing the load, extra overhead from our backend, that is WSGI application, and distributing that between Nginx and this one. So this is how our whole process works here. Okay, so request will come here to the web server, then web server will communicate to the WSGI server, and then it will call, it will invoke the callable function that is defined in our WSGI application. So this is the complete flow, okay, and this WSGI application then has the capability to interact with the database and serve static files. And what we can do is we can give the responsibility to our web server to serve the static files by itself, so that we can reduce the extra overhead from our backend. But if you are using JavaScript as a backend language, then there is no need to use this WSGI. Okay, this WSGI interface standard. There's no need to use this WSGI. The Node.js server that has been written by this JavaScript is itself enough for handling all the request. But with Node.js server, with this Node.js server, if you are using JavaScript as a backend language, then this Node.js server is capable to handle all the request. But if you use Apache or Nginx with this Node.js, I don't know Apache will work with Node.js or not, but if you use Nginx with this Node.js, then Nginx will help in serving static files and do the load balancing, and also it will help in reverse proxying, and also it will help. The code is written in such an efficient way. They have used some very good algorithms to distribute the traffic and handle the traffic in a very efficient manner. Okay. But one thing that I want to tell you is that, like, when you deploy your website, Django website on Heroku, it did not use anything like Nginx or Apache. It basically used GUnicorn only to deploy the website. But I will recommend that when you are deploying your website on AWS or Google Cloud Platform or Azure, then you must use this Nginx with GUnicorn to deploy your website. As I have already mentioned, what are the benefits of using this Nginx? And I hope now you should be able to apply the kernel and multi-threading concept in this one. Because like we understood earlier, like as soon as we start the process, kernel will allocate a kernel thread to that process, and then that kernel thread will actually give the life to the code, and then it will start passing the instructions written in that file to the CPU, right? And the file will be containing some machine code that can be understood by the CPU. Now, when you normally start a Django server on your local host by running the command python manage.pyrunserver, then what happens is you are not using at that time this GUnicorn or this Nginx Apache. You are not using that. At that time, what you are doing is you are using the development server of Django. You are using the development server. This development server has the code written in a very similar manner as written in this GUnicorn. But this development server you cannot use while deployment, because this development server is not safe from security point of view. It must be having certain vulnerabilities that can be exploited by the hacker or malicious user and can actually hack your website. So that's why it is not recommended to use this development server while deploying your website. Then what you do is you switch from this development server to this GUnicorn, and then you can also add the Nginx as a reverse proxy that will point towards this GUnicorn. But when you are in local environment in development mode, then this development server will help you to actually run your website and test it. Okay, now we will understand this development server first, like how it takes requests and uses different concepts of multi-threading or asynchronous programming, and then actually pass the request to our backend. Now let's start this development server first. Okay, now let's move towards the next slide, and that is, so now I have actually explained you what this WSGI server works and how this WSGI application links to this WSGI server and what is the work of this web server, like load balancing, static file serving and reverse proxy. Now let's move to the architecture diagram of the Django WSGI server, Django development server. Now what happens is, as soon as you write the command in terminal, python manage.pyrunserver, what it does is it will start a python.exe file. Okay, it will start one python.exe file, and this python.exe file is nothing but the file that contains the machine code of Python runtime environment. It will start the process of this Python runtime environment, and this python.exe file will contain the instructions of the Python interpreter, that is CPython by default. Okay, it will start running those machine codes, and then kernel will allocate a kernel thread to this file, this process, and start passing those instructions to the CPU. And then what it will do is it will start converting the high level code that is written in this Django built-in server file. It will start converting this high level Python code to a machine level code. And once it has converted this high level code that is written in this Django built-in server code file to a machine level code, then what it will do is this Python interpreter file, what it will do is it will tell the kernel thread, now I have converted all the high level code to machine level code, now you can start executing this code, okay, this new code that we have defined in here. And now the instructions written in this server code file has the capability to actually bind to the port that we mentioned, that we normally use, called as 8000 port. Okay, the default port is this, but you can change this port according to your own. Like you can use the command python manage.py run server 0.0.0.0:8001 or 80 itself. You can use any port while starting the local server. So the instruction written in this server code will actually bind this application to the port number 8000, and now currently it's in listening state. But now, since our website is not publicly accessible, now from your own system or from any device that is in local area network, you try to approach this server at a IP address at port number 8000, then you can actually serve your website. You can actually make a socket connection over there at port number 8000 by using a protocol of HTTP. And IP address will be, the default IP address chosen is 172.0.0.1. This is the IP address of localhost that is set by default in your system. But if you want another IP address that has been allocated by a router, then you can do that as I have shown you earlier. Now you have bind this application, your Django application, to this port number 8000, and now it's currently in listening state. Now we can actually process a request. Okay, now we can actually process a request, and the instructions written in this Django built-in server code are written in such a way that if someone now tries to communicate to this port number 8000, then what it will do is it will invoke this callable function that is defined in this wsgie.py file, callable function. And I will show you what I meant by this callable function. Now let's start one new Django application. Okay, let's create one new virtual environment and let's actually start one new Django application from scratch. So let's open the CMD here. And here let's move to D directory. And let's make a new folder here. And let's name it Advanced Django. And now let's move to this CD Advanced Django. And let's create a virtual environment here. Let's check first what the Python version I am using now. So Python version is 3.8.5, and I will recommend you to use a Python version that is greater than 3.8. Then we will create a virtual environment here. Virtual env advanced Django env. It will create one new virtual environment here, and it's ready. Now let's move to that. So source, or this command in Windows, advanced Django env /scripts/activate. So now I have started this advanced Django environment. Now let's actually install the Django, okay? Because Django is itself a pip library of Python. So let's install that. Pip install Django. And I will recommend you to use the Django version that is greater than 3.1, okay? Because we will be using WebSockets later on, and they have added some new functionality after 3.1. So that's why I will recommend you to use Django version that is greater than 3.1. pip install Django. And let's start a new project here by Django and even start project advance Django. Now let's move to this directory, cd advanced Django, and let's start a new app, Django admin start app advanced Django app. So now if I move to this advanced Django, it has created one new app, that is advanced Django app. And now let's open this on this VS Code. New window. And here I will open a open folder. Then PC, then the directory, then advanced Django, then advanced Django and select folder. I have set up the environment here. Let's now I will skip this part because I will basically include this app in settings.py and I will do the basic setup here that you must all be knowing, right? So I will skip that part. So now I have done the basic setup of Django application. Here I have defined one view here, a simple basic function of define index which takes the request and return the HTTP response started. Now you can also notice one file in our main Django project that is called as wsgi.py file. Now don't focus on this asgi.py file, we will focus on that later on, but currently focus on this file that is known as wsgi.py file. Now keep open. So now you can see here there is one callable function that is known as get wsgi application. So this is the callable function that I was talking about. Okay, this is the callable function. And what we will do is when we deploy our website normally, then we tell the GUnicorn that here this is a wsgi.py file that is located in this directory. We mention the whole path of this directory, and in this directory it basically invokes this function that is known as get wsgi application. Now how this get wsgi application works, I will tell you also. And now currently, since we are using our development server of Django, so Django itself has written one file for that server. But first, if we go to this get wsgi application here, then you can see here it all adds a layer of abstractions. Okay, now it will return one wsgi handler function, and if I press control and press click on it, then it will open one another file, and in this they have written some code to handle our request. Now how this handles the request, I will explain you that also. Whenever we start this Python script, whenever you start the Python manage.py run server, suppose let's start this server here using the command Python manage.py run server and press enter. Now it will start one Python script. If we open this process explorer here, then you can see here in respective to this VS Code process, you can see there is one python.exe file, right? Here in terminal here, as you can see here, there is a powershell.exe, and corresponding to that, there are two processes here, one python.exe and one python.exe file. So this python.exe file, the parent process is basically running because whenever we make any changes in this code of Python and press control save, then it will automatically reload. So the work of this python.exe main process is basically to reload the process. But if we start the process using the command python manage.py run server --- no reload, then it will start only one process. Okay, now if I go to process explorer, then you can see there is only one process running, that is python.exe file. And now if I make any changes to this code here in Django application and press control save, then it will not automatically reload. We have to manually stop the server and start the server again. Okay, and now in this python.exe file that I told you earlier, this is the same python.exe file that automatically runs whenever we start any process, but this python.exe file is converted the high level code of the server, of the server code that has been written by Django developers. So this python.exe file, the machine code present in that, basically converts that high level Python code into a machine level code by using a kernel thread. And now since it has converted, now it's actually executing that instructions. And those instructions are written in such a way that it has bind itself to the port number 80. Now if I go to the CMD here and press and write a command netstat -an, then you can see here there will be one more port that has been added here. If you search here, there will be one port 127.0.0.1:8000. So at 8000 port, our Django application has bind itself to this port, and now it's currently in listening state. Now if anyone tries to communicate to this port number or tries to make a socket connection on this port number 8000 at this IP address, Now, so it will actually make a socket connection, okay, because it is currently in listening state. So this is how it's all working. This is the main thread, main user level thread. And since we know in Python, for each user level thread, it allocates a new kernel thread. But at a single time, this single python.exe file or single Python runtime environment cannot actually allow more than one user level thread to actually pass its instruction to a different kernel, to a kernel thread. So if thread one, this main thread, is passing the instruction to its corresponding kernel thread, then other user threads will not be able to pass their instructions to their respective kernel thread that we have already covered, right? So now there's one main thread that is running. So on this main thread, it's actually passing the instructions to bind this Django application to this port, that is 8000 port. And also the instruction in that server file will be written in such a way that whenever someone tries to communicate to this 8000 port, it will actually call this function, that is a callable function that has been defined in our Django web application or Django framework. Okay, so let's look actually at this architecture diagram. So we have one python.exe file. Okay, now it's actually running the code. It's actually converted the code of this server file, and it actually binded this application to port number 8000. And now it is capable to take the requests that are coming to this 8000 port. And then it will invoke this function that is defined in wsgi.py file, that is get wsgi application. And then it will link to this Django and other custom code, that is urls.py, views.py. So now if I open the browser here and try to make a socket connection to this IP address. Now, as I open this web browser tab here, so this tab will be allocated a new port, right, to actually link to that port that is, but currently, since we are using my same local device, so both the endpoints will be on same device. So if I try to contact on this IP address at colon 8000, then press enter. So I have written one HTTP response. It started. So suppose I try to communicate from this Google Chrome. Suppose the IP address from this 127.0.0.1 colon some port that has been dynamically allocated to this Google Chrome. I try to make a socket connection or make a connection to this IP address, that is this one, 127.0.0.1 8000. But currently these both are on same device. So this is the communication that is taking place right now. And then what happened is, as soon as we try to communicate to this port number 8000 on which the server code is running, then it actually invoked this wsgi.py file callable function, that is get wsgi application. And then this application actually take this request to our Django custom code, and then it will actually call this view that is present here, define index request and return HTTP response. Then it makes the response and then forwards it to the client, that is this one. And if you want to know what is actually happening in this inside this, so what happens is, as soon as you start this application, then it starts this server, right? It will start as soon as you start this process, that is Python manage.py run server, then it will start converting this to machine level code and start actually executing this the instructions that are present in this server code. Then what it will do is, it will actually invoke this wsgi.py at that time also, so that it can load middlewares in starting only. So inside that, what happens is, I will open one more diagram here. So now let's not consider this ASDA handler. Let's consider this as a WSDI handler. Okay. So as soon as you start the process of this Python, that through Python manage.py run server, then what it will do is, and let's remove this ASDA. Currently we have a WSDI server. It will start executing the instructions that are present in this WSDI server. Then it will call this WSDI handler. This is a callable function that we have defined, that is get WSDI application. And then it will actually load the middleware stack, the middlewares that we have already defined. Because in Django, we have a full stack of middlewares that we define in the settings.py file. So if I open this settings.py file, you can see the middleware stack, right? These are the middleware stacks. So it will start, it will load this middleware stack in starting only, because these middlewares need to be accessed at each request. So instead of calling those middlewares at each request, what it does is it creates an object of these of this middleware in starting only, so that there is no need to call this middleware, call these middlewares again and again. It basically makes a object, it makes a object of this middleware stack in starting only. But when we actually request, we actually make a request, and this Django backend actually receive the request, it instantiate that object at each request. Okay, it makes the object in starting only, but instantiate that object at each request. And these middlewares basically act as layers through which each request needs to be passed. So basically there are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. There are currently 7 layers, okay, of middlewares right now. Okay, so whenever request comes, then it will pass through various things that we have already discussed. Like first it will have to, like currently we are using development server. So it will be approached to port number 80. Then it will be passed to this. Then server will handle that request, and then server code will actually invoke the WSGI callable function, and then it will be passed here to this middleware. Then this middleware object will be instantiated, and then this request object will be passed through this different layers of middlewares. And now if request satisfied all the instructions that we have mentioned in these middlewares, then it will be actually handled. Then it will pass to urls.py. So URL will be matched, and then the corresponding views will be called from views.py, and then the function in views.py will actually do some operations that we have defined, and then it will actually make a response and return an HTTP response. Okay, and then it will pass to the port, and then our server code will actually return that response to the client. So this is how it all works, right? Now we have a quite good understanding of how this development server is working, right? So now let's try to understand about this WSGI server of Django. So this is the basic default development server of Django, which gets open as soon as you hit the command python manage.py run server. Now, before actually understanding what is actually happening in this server, let's try to understand how the code works actually. So before actually understanding about the server, like how it works, let's first see the code and run our first basic URL, that is this one. Let's try to run our first view, that is this one, define index request and return HTTP response done. So this is one of the most basic view that we can make in our Django project. So now let's start the server by entering the command python manage dot py run server. So now as soon as we hit enter here, it will start one python server here on our port number 8000. So basically as soon as we start the server, this application will bind itself to the port number 8000, because Django has by default set it 8000. And now it will bind to this 8000 port and start listening on that. Now if any person tries to communicate on that port number 8000, it will be able to communicate to our Django application now. Now if I open the browser here, and on this browser tab, if I hit enter here, then you can see that we are getting a response of done here. HTTP response done. But now suppose if I write one more view here, that is define home request. And these are basically the simple synchronous views that we are talking about. Return HTTP response, and inside this home. And here I am using one more module of Python, that is time, import time. And I will use a time.sleep here, so that I will have to wait for about 20 seconds to actually get the response from our Django server. Now, if someone tries to call this URL of home, then he will have to wait for about 20 seconds before he will actually get the response of this home. Okay. So now if I open one more tab here, and from this tab I will try to contact this new URL that we have placed here. And also, before trying to communicate to this home view, we have to add one more URL here for that, and we will have to copy this URL here. Let's add one more path, that is home, and in views dot home, and name will be home. Control save. Now if I try to access this URL from my browser here and press enter here, now I will actually have to wait for about 20 seconds before I will actually get the response here. Now if I, in meantime, I try to access this URL here, I am getting the response immediately. Although I have not got the response from this URL, but if I refresh this page, I am getting the response instantly, right? But here, I will have to actually wait for about 20 seconds, and then after 20 seconds, I have got the response here. So how this Django server was actually able to handle multiple requests together? So basically, our Django server is using a multi-threading concept at a server level. Okay, it's actually using a multi-threading concept. And we will discuss about this whole multi-threading concept, like how Django is using this concept at server level to actually serve concurrent requests. Okay, we will discuss about that later on, but let's now try to see one more thing that is called as no threading here. Now if I start the server again using the argument that is called as no threading and hit enter here, and now if I try to open the two tabs here of browser, and now if I refresh this page of home, and now I will have to wait for about 20 seconds to actually get the response. Now in meantime, some other user comes on my website and try to access this URL. Then if I refresh this page, I will actually have to wait for about 20 seconds till I get the response for this. So as soon as I got the response for this URL here, after 20 seconds, only then our Django server was actually able to handle this request and process this request and actually return the HTTP response that we have returned here. Okay. Let's again do this. If I refresh this page, now currently I'm in time.sleep mode, so our server is now waiting for about 20 seconds so that it can return the HTTP response. Now in the meantime, some other user comes and tries to access this URL here, and if I refresh this page, now I will have to wait for this URL to give the response here. Once I have got the response here, only then I will get the response for this URL that we have opened in our new tab here. So in case of no threading argument that we have passed, our server was not actually able to use multi-threading concept for actually handling multiple requests, multiple concurrent requests. So what is happening is, if I give you a brief here, request one comes here on our server. Okay, let's say it's for home endpoint. Now this Python worker will actually allocate this request to a thread, let's say thread 1, and on this thread all the handling for this request 1 is actually happening. Okay, and as soon as we request for this URL that is home, it will call this wsj.py, and inside that wsj.py it will call this function that is called as get wsj application, and then it will access the custom code that we have written here, and also in between it will also load middlewares here. Okay, it will load middlewares here. I will talk about this middlewares later on, but now let's keep it very simple and let's try to understand what is happening here. After the request has reached here, it will try to match the URL that we have mentioned in the URL of browser here. Okay, it will match the URL that we have mentioned in our url.py, and since we have written the view of home corresponding to this URL, so it will call the view of home in our views.py file. And after that, it will actually handle the code that we have written here, that is time.sleep and HTTP response. So when we are using the concept of no threading here, then what happened was, like, our request one is currently in processing stage and it's currently in time.sleep mode, this thread one. Now if request 2 comes here, then the WSGI server of Python will actually see that our thread 1 is busy, okay, because it is currently handling the request 1. So now it is busy, so I cannot actually allocate this request 2 handling on this thread, okay. So now request 2 will actually have to wait for this request 1, for this thread 1 to actually return the response for this request 1. And once the response for this request 1 is given back, the connection will be broken. Connection will be broken between user and server, because here we are using a short term connection only. We are not using a persistent connection that we have studied about in socket connection. So here when request 2 comes, then it will have to actually wait for this thread 1 to actually return the response back. But when we didn't use this no threading, right? When we didn't use this no threading, our Python server can actually use the concept of multi-threading to process multiple concurrent requests, right? Now if request 1 comes here, now our Python server will actually allocate one new thread here, let's say T1, and all the handling for this request 1 will be handled by this thread 1. Now if request 2 comes, now Python server will see that one new request has arrived. So what it will do is it will allocate one new thread here, let's say it's thread 2, and allocate this request 2 to this thread 2. Now all the handling for this request 2 will be done on this thread 2. And as we know, for each Python user level thread, there will be a corresponding kernel thread level as well. So let's say for this thread 1, we have a kernel thread 1, and for this thread 2, we have a kernel thread 2. Now these threads can actually behave in a preemptive manner, because as we know, threads are preemptive in nature. Any thread can be interrupted in between by our user level thread manager, user level thread manager, right? It can actually interrupt the thread any in between and start running new thread. So our thread 1 and thread 2 will actually execute in this manner. Thread 1, thread 2, thread 1, thread 2. But this is not fixed, like for how much time thread 1 will run and for how much time thread 2 will run, because this global interpreter lock of CPython interpreter can be allocated, can be obtained by any of these thread anytime. So suppose if thread 1 is running and after it is interrupted, this thread 1 actually takes a GIL back, so thread 1 will start executing again. But if this thread 1 is interrupted in between and thread 2 takes the GIL, then thread 2 will start running. But since in thread 1 we are actually executing a time.sleep method to replicate a IO operation here, so when this thread 1 is actually executing this instruction, our kernel thread is idle for that time, right? Let's say it's 20 seconds. So for that 20 seconds, this kernel thread is idle. So our whole process is idle for that time. But now, since we are using this multi-threading concept here, so our user level thread manager can actually start executing this thread too, right? It can start executing this new thread that we have created for handling this request too. Now this thread 2 can start working, and that actually gave us the response of HTTP response that is done, and after 20 seconds we got the response for this thread 1. So this is how our server is actually using the multi-threading concept. So this is a basic flow that I showed you right now, but now let's actually move a bit more deeper inside this WSJ server to actually understand how the server is working, okay. So now what I have done is I did some configuration here to actually show you how this WSGI server actually works. So I have already opened this process explorer here. You can also open this process.explorer, and whatever I do, you can also repeat side by side so that you can actually understand what is happening. Now, as soon as I start this pythonmanage.py run server here, the simple without no threading, and as soon as I hit enter here, it will start running one server on my machine, right? And that server code is actually written in Python itself. Now, what is happening here is that as soon as we hit the pythonmanage.py run server, then what happened was our kernel allocated some resources to the process that we are requesting for. Okay, it allocated some resources in RAM and associated one kernel thread. Let's say it K1 to our process. Let's say it P1. And for that P1, there was one file that is called as python.exe file, python.executable file that is necessary to actually execute, start executing initially on Windows operating system. That is .exe file. And if you are on Linux, then this .exe extension will be different for you. So now we have a kernel thread that is associated to this process one. And in starting, we have only one thread, right? So on this process P1, we have one user level thread. Let's say U1. And corresponding to that user level thread, we have kernel thread one. And let's say this user level thread one or this kernel thread one as a main thread. Okay, this is the main thread. And the code written in python.exe file is nothing but the machine level code for providing the Python runtime environment, right? To provide a Python runtime environment. So now kernel thread one is actually executing those instructions. So now the kernel thread is actually passing those instructions that Python developers have written in this python.exe file to provide a runtime environment. And after it has executed those instructions, so now what it will do is it will start. Now, since we have mentioned this python.exe to actually execute the server code that Django developers have written, the default WSGS server code that is written in Python itself. Okay, it is written in Python itself. So now the code that is written in this python.exe file will start converting the instructions that are written in this Python, that is a high level language here, in which the code is written on this WSGS server code. It will start converting that code into a machine level code. Okay, so it will convert this high level language code into a machine level code line by line and will start passing those instructions to the CPU. And CPU will execute those instructions. And now this python.exe file, you can consider that currently we are only having the main thread here. Now the instructions in this server code are written in such a way that this main thread, or let's call it thread one, will actually bind itself to the port number 8000 here. Okay, let's rub erase all this stuff here. So it will bind itself to the port number 8000 here. That is thread one here. That is the main thread. Okay, as you can see here, if I start the server here, as I've started only, so if I go to this python.exe here, and you can see that the parent python.exe is just for reload. Like if anytime we press control save here or make changes in our Django code, it will reload the server. Okay, it's the task of this process is nothing but to reload our server. And this python.exe, the second process, is our main process, which is actually handling all the stuff. So as you can see here, currently we are having only one main thread, that is called as python.exe. We have one more thread here, but we will discuss about this thread later on. But let's focus on this main thread. Okay, so now this main thread is actually binded to this port number 8000 and is currently in listening mode. Now if any requests come on this port for making a socket connection between user and server, this thread one is basically responsible for that, for making a socket connection. Okay, for making a socket connection. And the code for that, for making a socket connection, is written in this code, right? In this one, server code. And we have already understood about what is this socket connection, so I will not explain you right now. So once the socket connection is established, then how will the request will actually be handled by our url.py, by our views.py, and all that stuff. So what happens is, like if request one comes, then this thread one, which is listening on this port number 8000, it will make a socket connection with this user that is requesting for, okay, this request one to the server. And once this socket connection is actually established, then what this thread one will do, this thread one will actually call, and before this request one actually comes here, before all this socket connection, what our server will do is, as soon as we start this server code, it will also call one, it will also do some basic setup, some basic default setup to make our server ready for handling the request. Okay, it will have to make some configuration at backend so that it can be ready for actually handling the request, because this thread one that is responsible for handling all this request and making a socket connection is not enough for handling all the backend process, right? We have to do certain more things. We have to call some more functions, right? So as soon as we start the server here, and now the role comes of this second thread that we were talking about here. Okay, this second thread. So what will happen is, this server code will start one new thread here. It will create one more thread here that is called as thread 2. Let's call it thread 2. And on this thread 2, it will call, it will basically invoke one function that is mentioned in this wsdi.py file. Okay. There is one file in your Django project that I will show you right now. If I open this project here, you can see one file here that is called as wsdi.py in your project folder. And inside this, there is one function that is called as getWSJApplication, and this is basically called as callable function, which actually acts as an interface between our server code and our Django application code. Okay, this getWSJApplication callable function will actually act as an interface between this WSJ server that is mentioned in this code and this custom code that is WSJApplication. Right, this is the interface. So now this server code has thread one that is called as main thread, so it will create one more thread here that is called as thread two, and on that thread two it will call this function that is called as getWSDIApplication. Okay, now let's move to the code here. What is actually happening here? Let's press control and let's click on this getWSGApplication to actually parse, to actually see what actually is happening. Okay, we are now actually entering into the code that Django has written for us. Okay, so now you can see that it is returning one object of this class that is called as WSGAHandler. And don't focus on this right now, because this is something that I have added manually. Okay. And this is not the custom code. This is actually the code that Django has already built. But this is something that I have added in that code to actually see how the server actually works. And now if I press control and again click on this WSJHandler, then you can see one more class here, the actual class of WSJHandler here. Okay. Now this is also some code that I have written manually to actually see how the server is working, that I will show you later on. But now let's focus on what is happening inside this. So there is one class that is called as WSJHandler, and as soon as we return the object of this WSJHandler here, because we have actually called the constructor of this class by actually calling this parenthesis. If you know about the OOPS concept, object oriented programming, you must be knowing how to actually create an object of a class, right? So to create an object of a class, we actually have to use the class name and pass the parenthesis here, opening and closing. So it will call the init method of Python that we have declared inside this class. So this init method will actually instantiate this class that is WSJHandler here. Okay, it will instantiate that and perform some logic here. And it will also load some middlewares here. Okay, it load middlewares. The middlewares that we have defined inside this settings.py. So here we have added some 7 middlewares. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. And now what is the function of this self.load middleware is that it will not actually call those functions. What it will do is that it actually load all the middleware chain. It will create one object here to actually store all the middlewares in the sequence, so that when actually the request comes, suppose request 1, then we will call all those functions that we have chained in this load middleware. Okay, then it will call those middlewares one by one that we have mentioned in the settings.py for this request one to actually process this request. And now once the middlewares are loaded in this object, then this will actually return the object of this WSJ handler to the thread 2. Okay, now there is one thread 1 and thread 2, and on this thread 2 there is an object of WSJ handler which is capable of actually processing the request and returning the response. And this thread 1 actually can call this thread 2 anytime when it wants, because this thread 2 is actually created inside this thread 1. This thread 1 actually started one new thread, thread 2, inside that. Okay, and this thread 1 is actually responsible for making socket connection and actually giving back the response that is given by this thread 2 to thread 1. So now this object is ready on thread 2. Now our server setup has been done, and now our server is basically ready to actually process the request and return the response. So till now what we have discussed, let's see how it actually looks. Okay, so what I have done is, like inside this getWSJ application, when we call this function, inside this function I have printed this thread ID, like kernel thread ID, to actually know on which thread it is actually running this function. Okay, to actually show you what I told you in theory right now, I will show you practically like how it's getting executed on different threads. And I have also included its thread ID inside this. Like when we call this WSJ handler, then inside this init method I have also printed one function, like init function thread, like in what thread this init function is called, so that we can actually know which thread is doing what. So now if I press Ctrl+C here, and now again start the server here, pythonmanage.py run server, then you can see that first function that was invoked, that was called, was getWSJ application thread. So inside this, we have defined one function here, that is print getWSJ application thread and the thread ID. And the thread ID is 4732. If I open Process Explorer here, I can show you the real thread ID as well. So this is the main process. Here we can see all the threads that are running. So you can see that you can ignore these NTDLL because these are basically for background tasks. You can focus just on this python.exe, which is the main thread, and these threads that are starting from UCRT base. Okay, you have to focus only on these threads because these are basically background kernel threads to actually handle all the stuff. But you have to focus on these threads only, like these basically are kernel threads for user level threads. These are basically these five are kernel threads that are actually responsible for handling all the background process that are managed by kernel only. Okay, corresponding to these kernel threads, there is no user level thread, but there are two user level threads right now in our process, that is main thread, that is thread 1, and this is thread 2. Okay, so we have two user level threads, and corresponding to those user level threads, we have two kernel threads as well, as we have discussed in Python earlier. Now you can see that 12204 is not shown anywhere, right? But we can see this 4732 here, because as we had discussed earlier, 12204 is basically responsible for making a socket connection and is currently in listening state on that port. Okay, it will actually take the request, and then from this thread it will call this thread 2, for which we are seeing the results here, because these functions are basically called inside this thread with the thread ID, that is 4732. So now currently we are having two threads, right? Thread 1 and thread 2. And currently we have not made any request to the server. And you can see that in views.py, we are performing a synchronous function here. And inside this second synchronous function, we are basically performing a IO based operation, because we are just replicating a IO based operation with this time.sleep. But you can actually perform a IO based task like database operation or calling a third party API call using requests. I will show you later on that one. But currently let's focus on these synchronous views that are simple defined functions. But now if I try to request on these views by requesting on their corresponding URLs, then let's see what will happen. And let's also add one more thing here, like we will see on which thread ID these views are actually running. So let's print one more thing here, and before that let's import threading, and now let's add this here, print threading and to distinguish between both the functions, let's add index str. We have to convert it into string to actually append both the terms. And now here also we will print home str threading dot get native id. We have forgot to put this here, threading dot get native id. Control save. Now let's open two different tabs here, and now you can see that our kernel thread id is changed because our server is refreshed here. Okay, now we have to again open this python.exe, and you can see there are two threads right now. One is 8608 and one is 9984. So our 9984 is basically the main thread, right? Now if I try to request these two endpoints here, like this one. Now let's first try to request this one so that we can actually check that our server is able to handle multiple requests or not concurrently, and refresh. You can see that we are getting an immediate response for this request, right? Even though our second URL is basically currently waiting for its response. So now our server is able to actually handle two different requests concurrently, and you can see that both the functions are on different threads, as you can see that. And one thing also we need to focus is that we have also got this call function thread. Okay, this call function thread. And now what is this? I will show you right now. So inside this WSGI handler that we discussed earlier, what we were doing is we are just creating the object for this class. So when the object is created, the init method is called. But now to actually start executing, start pre-processing on the request that we are sending, we have to call this call function. And this call function is basically a special function in Python that we can call using the object's name of this class by the object's name and a parenthesis. Like suppose you have a class name WSDI handler, and you suppose created its object by putting its object inside this A. So now if you want to call the call function of this WSGI handler, then you can call this function by actually doing this A and brackets. So in this way you can actually call this call function of this class and actually start pre-processing on the request, because inside this call we have actually done the pre-processing for this request, actually calling this view and actually calling those middlewares that we have loaded earlier inside this object of A, right? We have earlier loaded on the middlewares, but we have not actually called, because there was no reason to call those middlewares, because till that time we have not got any request. Because first we have to retrieve the request, and then we can actually call the middlewares corresponding to that request and call the view inside our views.py, right? So once we have got the request, this call method is called on the thread 2, right? So basically what happens is, this is a thread 1, right? Which is basically responsible for making a socket connection. So on this thread 1, we are actually getting the request 1. Now request 1 comes to this thread. Now this thread 1 actually calls thread 2 inside this. And inside this thread 2, we have the object of this WSGI handler. Let's say we have a object of this WSGI handler as A. But now this thread 2 creates one more thread for this request 1. So let's say thread 3. Now this thread 3 ID is basically this one that we have got here as call function, because on that thread we are actually calling this call function, that is 15748. This is the thread ID of our new thread, right? This is the thread ID of thread 2 and this is the thread ID of thread 3, right? So now it is calling one new thread here for actually pre-processing and all the handling for this request 1. Now what it does is, inside the thread 2, it creates one new thread 3, and the target function for this thread 3 is basically the call function of the WSGI handler class. Okay, so to call this, the target function will be A and parenthesis. In this way, we can actually call this call function. Okay, and we will pass all the arguments as well of this request to actually start pre-processing on this request 1. So now all the handling will be done for this request one by this thread 3. Now in the meantime, if request 2 comes, then this thread 1 can actually take this request. But since our thread 3 is currently performing in task, let's say it's performing a CPU intensive task. Let's say it's performing a CPU intensive task. So then also it can, then also this request 2 can be taken by this thread 1, because it is being said by the thread scheduler that if request comes, then this thread 1 will be given priority. And then this thread 1 will actually send this request to thread 2. And this thread 2, which has the object for this WSGI handler, will create one more thread, that is thread 4. And the target function will be A and parenthesis. And in this, the arguments will be passed of this request 2. And this thread 4 is basically responsible now for handling all the pre-processing and all the handling for this request 2. So now we have four threads right now, thread 1, thread 2, thread 3 and thread 4. Now these all the threads can actually behave in a preemptive manner, right? In a preemptive manner. Now suppose if this thread 3 is actually performing an IO based operation, then it's obvious that our scheduler will start executing this thread 4. But even though if thread 3 is performing a CPU intensive task, then also these threads can actually behave in a preemptive manner. Like thread 3 is running for some time, then thread 4, then thread 3, then thread 4. And it is not fixed that which thread will run for how much time. But if but since we have multiple threads here, if one thread is performing an IO based operation, then at that particular time, we can actually process other requests and start executing that. So here we can actually reduce the overall time here. Okay. So here we are able to use the resources efficiently of this single process that is running here. Okay, we have a single process, but then also with the help of multi-threading, we are able to process the request here. And basically, when you make a web application, in most of the requests, you have to make some IO operation, because in most of the requests, you have to make a database operation, which will perform some queries and then give the response. So we generally perform some IO based operation in those, in these web applications. So that's why multi-threading can be advantageous to us a lot. Now let's take one more example here. So here what we saw was in views.py, we actually saw two things in which we actually performed some IO based operation, right? Because this was actually done to replicate the IO based operation, right? IO operation. But now let's actually perform some CPU intensive task, so that you can see that we cannot actually reduce the overall time, but we can run these two threads in a preemptive manner, like thread 1, thread 2, thread 1 and thread 2. In this way we can run. Let's see that. Okay, now let's perform some CPU intensive task here. Let's comment this and let's perform some CPU intensive task for I in range 10,000, and now let's print I here. Control save. Now let's call the URL of home here, which will perform CPU intensive task. So now it's running, but if I call this in between, then I will get the response immediately, because this thread was running in such a way, like our, let's say that our, that thread 1 for this home was thread 3. So now thread 3 is executing, but since it was preempted in between, even though it's a CPU intensive task, but then also it can be interrupted in between. And suppose GIL lock is obtained by thread 4, so it can start executing. And now thread 4 is actually executing only this one, like it is only returning a HTTP response. So it can actually return the HTTP response to the user, and this thread 1, thread 3 can start executing afterwards. Okay, so this is how we are actually performing the CPU intensive task here. So we have discussed about CPU intensive task and IO based operation as well, which we did through time.sleep. And now you can also perform a IO based operation like database operation and a third party API call. And inside this synchronous views, since we are using synchronous views, we can normally perform a database operation. There is no need to actually use some other ways which we actually use while in async views, because in async views, we don't have, because currently in Python, we don't have any module to actually perform database operation in asynchronous manner, like we had, like in, if we are using synchronous views and we are using requests library to actually call third party API call, But if you want to actually call a third party API in asynchronous views or asynchronous programming, then you have to switch to a different library called as AIU HTTP. Right? So this is the thing. Let's say, now let's actually perform some real IO based operation here. So let's take one more example here. Define call API. Request. Now we have to import one more library here. That is import requests, and then requests dot get. Now I have one third party API which is open to all, which basically returns the real time update of prices of different cryptocurrencies, right? So I have one third party API. I will copy that, okay, and that is the result. And then we will actually result equals to result.json, and let's print result to see that we are actually getting the result or not. Print result, return HTTP response, done. And here we will also see on which thread it is actually running. Okay, and it is here call API, control save. And now let's add one more URL here for this view. Call API. But I need a internet connection for this, so I will connect to my hotspot right now. Now if I try to access this endpoint of this call API, let's open one more tab here. Call API. Then it will actually wait for this result to come, and then it will return the response here. So when our thread that is allocated to actually process this request for calling the third party API, suppose the thread allocated is thread 3. Now to actually perform an IO based operation, it will have to make a request to kernel, right? Which we had already discussed. So suppose, let's say for thread 3, we have a kernel thread 3, and now kernel thread 3 will actually request kernel to grant permissions to actually perform one IO based operation. So now this CPU will actually execute this kernel code here, and this kernel code will actually call this third party server to actually give the response back. So here we have a server here, this is our own server, and we are calling one third party server, and we are requesting this using this API of that server, and then we are actually waiting for the response to come here. So for that time, when it is waiting for this response, when this kernel thread is in blocked state, so at that particular time, this thread 3 is idle. Okay, this kernel thread 3 is idle for that time. And now at that time, we can actually process some other request, because we are using a multi-threading concept at server level, right? And you can notice one thing, that these threads that are running here, these two threads, that is 18236 and 4144, these two threads are not basically for request. These can be considered as a internal threads, because for each request that we are creating a new thread, those threads are creating at that time only and are getting removed from this thread stack after we are returning the response, right? So when the response is actually given back, the connection is broken between the user and the server, because we are making a short-term connections, not a persistent connections, because for persistent connections we have to use WebSockets, but currently we are using a protocol that is HTTP 1.1, and this is the limitation of WSGI server. We can't use a protocol of HTTP 2.0 and WebSockets. We can't use these protocols to actually make a socket connection. This is the limitation of this WSGI server. We will discuss about this later on when we actually implement the ASJS server, but currently we are on WSJS server, so let's focus on this HTTP 1.1 only right now. So let's call two URLs here, one for call API and one for simple, and let's actually see that we are able to handle two concurrent requests at same time or not. First of all, threads are preemptive, so we can actually run this request in between, even though we are performing some CPU intensive task. But since we are performing some IO based operation, then for that particular time when it's idle, we can actually execute the instructions here. So as to decrease the overall time, right? So now refresh this. We got the instant response, and here we are actually waiting for the response, right? But we are able to get the instant response here. And you can see for both requests, there will be a different thread ID, right? There will be a different thread ID because WSJS server will actually create one new thread for each request. There are default thread 1 and thread 2, one for making a socket connection, and this thread 2 will contain the object for WSJS handler, but this thread 2 will actually create separate threads for each request, right? So we have thread 3 and thread 4. Thread 3 for handling this one IO operation, and thread 4 act for this index. So for index, we got the 15708. And on that side only, we call this call function of WSJ handler. And here, if I scroll up, because it was a long response, we were not actually able to see the threads. Now let's comment this to actually print the result, and let's again call the URL. Okay, let's again hit the API, and you can see currently this thread. This is a thread 2 ID. So now, if I refresh. And refresh, you can see that there is another thread that was created for handling this call API, that is 9804, and another thread for handling this index, right, that is 2396. So for each request are different threads, and now those all threads can actually behave in a preemptive manner, right? Now let's take one more example, that is, and now if you want to perform some database operation, that also you can perform simply. Like suppose if I import from dot models import students, I have created one table in database, that is students table, student table, in which I have put 10 records right now. Okay, I have added 10 records in the database table, but since we have not added a lot of records in database, so we will get the response from this database at a very fast speed. Okay, now if I go to admin panel and show you the records there, you can see there is a table called as students, and inside this there are 10 records right now. And you can see here, like when we call this admin, then also we are calling this call function thread, and for each request it is making a different thread, right? 20416, 20416. And it's also possible that let's say thread 3 is created for handling one request, and for this request one, the response is given back and the connection is broken with that user. But now the request 2 comes here, and before the thread 3 is actually deleted from the thread stack, this request 2 is given to thread 3, and now this thread 3 will actually process this request 2. Okay, that can also happen. Now let's make a database operation here, database operation call. So we can call that simply by using students equals to student dot object dot all print students. But as soon as we request this endpoint, we will get the response at such a fast pace that we will not be able to actually switch to a different tab and call another URL. If I refresh this page, you will get the result immediately, right? And for this, you will have this N9156. But here we are performing a database operation, which is an IO based operation, and this will be handled in a similar manner as we call this third party API. These are basically our different kinds of IO based operations and will be considered as the same. So now we have discussed about these synchronous views, and we have discussed about CPU intensive tasks and also IO based operation. Now let's take one more case. Now let's talk about one more thing. Now, this Django framework is actually providing us ASGI support as well, right? To actually use asynchronous programming at server level, it is also providing this ASGI server also. We will discuss about ASGI server later on, but let's now assume that in ASGI server, we can use async views only. Let's assume now, we can also use sync views also, but let's assume we can use async views, okay? So now, Django also provide this support of ASGI server and asynchronous programming at server level. Now, the Django developers have developed the code of this Django application that we are using, and currently I'm using a Django 3.1.7 version. So in this version, they have written the code in such a way that our views, that our WSGI server is actually capable to handle both type of functions, that is synchronous, that we normally call right now, using this simple views like define home and request. But now this WSGI server is also capable to actually handle async function as well. Okay. Now, if we define some async functions here, like suppose if I change this view from sync to async using async here, then also our WSGI server will be able to run this view. If I press Control Save here, and now if I try to access this endpoint by refreshing this, you can see we are actually running this function as well. And how was this possible? I will show you that right now. As we had already discussed about this thread 1 and thread 2 that are created automatically as we start the server, right? So these threads, like this thread is basically for making a socket connection and listening on this port number 8000. And when the request comes, it will call this thread 2 and pass this request 1 on this request on this thread 2, right? And this thread 2 will actually create a new thread for actual handling of this request 2, right? It will create one thread 3 for actual handling of this request 2. And this thread 2 contains basically the object of WSGI handler, right? And now if request 2 comes, then it will go to thread 1. Then thread 1 will pass this to the thread 2. This is the request 1 and this is the request 2. And now this thread 2 will make a new thread for actual handling of this request 2, right? That is thread 4. So these two threads that we are talking about that are automatically created as we start the server, these two threads can be referred as internal threads because they are used for internal purposes by our server code. Okay, these two threads are generally created by this server code that Django developers have written, the development server code, and these are internal threads, right? But the threads that this thread 2 is creating for actual handling of this request are known as threads for handling request. Now, what we can do is we can actually limit these threads. Like in starting only, we can specify how many threads can be created by this thread 2 at a single time, at a single point of time. So if we use the argument no threading while starting the server, then this thread 2, these two threads, that is thread 1 and thread 2, will be there only. And we can also have some more kernel threads for internal purposes, right? Which may be used by this server for performing some background task. And maybe these internal threads are used by the kernel itself. These are kernel threads and these are used by kernel itself to manage this particular process that we have created here. Let's say it is a P1 process. So kernel can actually create some more kernel threads for actual management of this process, right? But here, this thread 1 and thread 2, for which we have a kernel thread also, like let's remove these, and let's say K1 and K2. Let's say these are the kernel threads corresponding to these user level threads. Now these threads are basically internal threads. But if we use this no threading concept here, no threading argument, then this thread 2 can only create one thread at a single time. It cannot create thread 4 when we have thread 3 running already. So if request 1 is being handled by this thread 3, so now if request 2 comes, it will reach to this thread 2, but this thread 2 cannot actually create one more thread for actual handling of this request 2. So when this thread 3 will forward its response to this thread 2, and then thread 2 will return the response to this thread 1, and this thread 1 will actually return the response to the user back and breaks the connection. Then this thread 2 can actually allocate this request to the same thread or create a new thread here, let's say thread 4, and this thread 3 is removed, and now thread 4 is assigned the responsibility of this request 2. So at a single time we can only create one thread from this thread 2 using this no threading concept. We cannot actually use the multi-threading concept here. But let's say, but in JUnicorn, if you are in deployment server and you are using JUnicorn, which we will talk about later on. So if, but if you are using this JUnicorn and you will switch from this Django built-in server code to this JUnicorn, and this is also a kind of Python server only, a Python WSGI server only, and you will use this JUnicorn to actually deploy your website, because this is safe from security point of view and can actually manage the traffic coming. Okay, so now in this JUnicorn you can actually mention the threads here. Let's say I set this thread property as 4. Now these thread 1 and thread 2 will be there only, but now this thread 2 can actually create 4 more threads at a single point of time. If 4 requests come concurrently, it can create more 4 threads concurrently, and these threads can actually handle these requests in a preemptive manner. But we cannot actually run these threads in a real parallel mode, because if we are using a single process, we cannot actually use multiple CPU cores in Python. We had already discussed about that. At a single time, only one thread will be running. In JUnicorn, you can specify number of threads in starting only. And in development server, we can only use this no threading, so that we can only use one thread for handling request. But if we remove this no threading, then we can create multiple threads for each request that is coming. But there is one more case that I want to talk about is, and that is async functions. Now the Django developers have developed the Django code in such a way that the Django code is actually able to handle this async functions as well, async views or async functions, because this async function can be anywhere, in middlewares, in views, anywhere. Okay, and now our WSGI server here is capable to run this async function as well, which we can use only if we have a event loop inside our thread that we had already discussed about while understanding the basics of asynchronous programming. We have to start one event loop on our thread. Let's say it's a thread, and now we have to start one event loop to actually start running this async function, right? We have to use some function like async io dot run, and then we will pass this function here inside this and run this. This will create one event loop on the thread and start running all this function that we have defined here. And then this function will be registered as a coroutine on this event loop and start running on that. Or what we can do is we can start a loop by loop.getEventLoop and then loop.createTask. We can use any function of async IO available to actually start one event loop on the thread and then register the async function as a coroutine on this event loop. Okay, and we cannot actually register a simple synchronous function on this event loop. We can only register those functions that are coroutines, and to make a coroutine you have to use this async command here. Like before defining any function, you have to use this async to actually make a coroutine, and then you will register that coroutine on this event loop, and then this event loop will manage all the stuff. And these coroutines that are registered on this event loop will actually behave in a cooperative manner, right? So now they have developed the code of the Django application in such a way that our Django application can actually start running the asynchronous functions as well. So how was that possible? And they have developed this kind of thing because they are also providing ASGI support as well. And the main motive to add this functionality is that, like, suppose if you want to switch to ASGI server from this WSGI server, and in ASGI server it's necessary to use async functions, although in some cases synchronous functions will also run in this ASGI server, but that may degrade performance of this ASGI server in some cases. So they have added this async compatibility of this WSGI server, so that if we want to switch anytime from this WSGI to ASGI or ASGI to WSGI, then our Django application will be able to actually handle any kind of use. You may experience some kind of degradation of performance in using synchronous views in AJS server, but it will run, okay? It will not just block that function or give some error. Okay, in WSGA, there is no issue at all. You can run any function here, whether it's a synchronous function or whether it's an asynchronous function. I will tell you about how this WSGA server actually handles the async function, and let's discuss about that, like how it actually handles that. So let's say you define one function inside the views.py file as async define function. And before that, let's actually implement this in the code, okay? Let's actually add this inside our code so that you can see that it's working or not. So this is our view. This is a define home request. And now let's say I will add async here in this view and press control save. Now let's start the server here. You can see that our thread 2 is allocated this thread ID, that is 8080, and now our server is running. Now if I go to browser here and call this URL of home and refresh this page here, you can see that it is actually running this async view as well. And you can see that our view was called on this thread, that is 532. So our thread 2 created this new thread here, right? Our thread 2 here, which was 532, sorry, thread 3, our thread 2 was this one, and this thread 2 allocated a task of request 1 that we sent on this URL of home. It allocated a task to this thread 3, so this is the request 1 is passed to this thread 3, and now when we call this async function here, it is actually calling one more thread. Okay, because we are getting a new thread ID here when we are printing print home threading.getNativeID, we are getting one more thread ID, that is 22752. So it is creating one more thread here, that is thread 4. So now let's actually understand what is happening here. Okay, Let's clear the screen. So what is happening actually is that as soon as we call this async function, it cannot actually call this function on the thread directly. It will have to create one event loop on the thread and start running that. So let's say this is a thread 1, thread 2, and thread 2 created one more thread, that is thread 3, for handling this request. And now this thread 3 is running. It is calling all the middlewares because we have to call some more middleware functions before actually calling the view, right? So this thread 3 will actually call all those middlewares, and then when we are actually calling the view in views.py, what it will do is it will see that our view is basically an async or synchronous function. So on this thread 3, the code is written in such a way that it has the capability to check whether our function is async or synchronous function, and that it do by using the function that is known as is coroutine function. It will pass that function as a argument to this function, that is coroutine function. And this will find whether that view or function is a async or not. And if it's async, and since we are not having any event loop on this thread 3, what it will do is it will create one more thread. It will create one more thread here, and on thread 4, it will start a event loop. It will start one event loop on this thread 4, and on this event loop, it will register that async view that we have defined in views.py. It will be registered as a coroutine on this event loop and start executing on this thread 4. Okay, let's say C1 for the async view that we have defined. That's why we got the thread 4 native ID as a new one, right? When we call the threading.native ID inside this function of async, we get a new thread ID, right? So WSGA handler call function is called on this thread 3. But our view is actually called on this thread 4, on this event loop. So how does this thread 3 creates a new thread and starts running a event loop on that thread? How does it do that? So it do that by using a wrapper function that is known as async to sync. And the meaning of this is that we are calling our asynchronous function inside this synchronous function, because this function that we have called in views.py, that is also called inside some function, right? So that function is basically a synchronous function because it is actually running on this thread 3, and on this thread 3 we don't have an event loop, right? So on this thread 3 we call one function inside which it called one async function. So we have to call that async function using this async to sync. We have to use the syntax that is known as async to sync, and inside this we have to pass the function here of view. And this async to sync, and there is one more wrapper function that is known as sync to async that I will talk about later on. These two wrapper functions are very important, and these are basically added in a module that is known as ASGIREF. So this async to sync is basically used to call an asynchronous function inside a synchronous function, or inside a thread if on which there is no event loop. So now this async to sync wrapper function, what it will do is it will create one more thread, and on that thread 4 it will start running one event loop. It will start running one event loop and register that coroutine of async view, right? It will create one more thread, and on that thread we will start executing that function. And now in this async view that we have called here, in this async view we can actually create more coroutines, like await async io dot sleep 10, and we can actually use asynchronous programming inside this async function, okay? Because it is currently executing on a coroutine, another coroutine of a event loop on another thread, okay? So now we are having four threads, thread 1, thread 2, these threads are basically for internal purposes, and then thread 3 for handling the request. But inside this thread 3 we actually created one more thread 4, but for handling the request only this thread will be considered. So if we have mentioned while deployment in JUnicorn that we can actually use four threads, so this thread will not be counted in that thread. So now if request comes, another request comes, it will be allocated a new thread, that is thread, that will be thread 5, and now these two threads will be considered as a request handling request. But internally we can create as many threads as we want, whether using threading module or whether using a wrapper function that we have used here, that is async to sync. And this async to sync is also using some threading concept inside, because this async to sync basically adds a abstraction layer, but inside this it must be using some threading concept here to actually create one more thread, and on that thread it is actually creating a event loop. So internal of these threads we can create as many threads as we want, but server can actually create whatever threads that you have mentioned while deployment. So only those threads will be considered as a request handling request, but internally you can create as many threads as you want, okay? So now all these threads that you have declared here, that is thread 3, thread 5 for request 2, this thread 3 for request 1, and you have declared one more thread, thread 4, and now all these threads will be executed in a preemptive mode, okay? Because at top level we have a user level thread manager which can preempt any of these threads anytime and start running a different thread. But inside this thread 4 we have an event loop running, and on this event loop we can actually register more and more coroutines as we want and start executing these coroutines on this event loop on this thread 4. And now these coroutines will actually behave in a cooperative manner. But since it is, and this event loop basically works internally inside of thread, okay? Event loop basically works internally of this thread. So this event loop doesn't have a control of this user level thread manager. Actually, user level thread manager doesn't know about this event loop. So it can even preempt this thread 4 when it is actually executing a coroutine, and this coroutine is actually behaving a CPU intensive task when it is not even in idle state, then also this user level thread manager can actually preempt this thread 4 and start executing other threads, because event loop is working internally, right? Although on this event loop, these coroutines will behave in a cooperative manner, but at a higher level, these threads will behave in a preemptive manner only. If you have only one thread, if you specify that you can only use one thread for request handling, then these coroutines will work only, and now it will not be interrupted in between. If this thread 4 will not be interrupted in between, and these coroutines can actually work internally of this thread 4 without any interruption of this user level thread manager, because we have only one thread at a single time. So now if you perform, make a clean diagram here. So we have thread 1, thread 2, thread 3, thread 4 on which event loop is running. And now suppose the coroutine that you have registered in this event loop is performing a CPU intensive task. So now if other coroutines are also registered on this event loop, let's say it's a C1, C2, C3. So C2 and C3 can't actually start executing in between when this C1 is executing, because coroutines actually behave in a cooperative manner. Once the CPU intensive task is actually finished, or the C1 is actually idle for a particular period of time, then this event loop can only switch to a different coroutine. But in between, while this C1 is executing and not in idle state, then this C1 will continue working. But if we have one more thread here, thread 5, for another request, then it's possible that user level thread manager can actually start interrupting this thread 4 and start executing this thread 5. But now suppose if this C1 is actually performing a IO based operation, now other coroutines can also work. But suppose it's performing a IO based operation, and now our user level thread manager actually switches to this thread 5, then this thread 1 start executing. And in that way, we can actually reduce the overall time, because this is performing IO based operation and is currently waiting for the device to actually return the response. So that time we can use efficiently to process other request. Or what we can do is, like, if there is no preemption or no interruption, then this event loop will start executing other coroutines that are registered on this event loop. So in this case, there will be no wastage of resources, and we will be handling the resources efficiently in this manner. Okay, using this async to sync, because as soon as we call this async to sync, it is creating a new thread here, right? And on that thread, it's actually performing some task on the event loop. Now let's take an example and let's actually see what is happening here. So we have one async view here, and currently we are performing some CPU intensive task here. And if there is nothing inside this, if we are only rendering this HTTP response, then it's no problem whether use a sync, whether use async. And in WSGI server, even if you use async, there is no problem at all, because it doesn't lead to any degradation of resources, because this async is called inside async to sync wrapper and a new thread is allocated. So in this WSGI server, there is no wastage of resources at all. There is nothing to worry about on your side. You just have to write your simple code and use any async or sync view here and start executing your code. Now let's take one example here. Let's place a CPU intensive task here. That is that it will iterate from this 0 to this number, let's say 10,000, and it will print. And let's remove this await here, and we will use this await async io.sleep when we will try to replicate the IO operation. But now we are performing some CPU intensive task here, and now let's actually start two browsers here. We have opened two browsers here because we have to make a request to a single URL, exact same URL concurrently. If you try to open a new tab here and try to request on this URL, then it will be blocked by browser itself. It will not be blocked by our server, but it will be blocked by browser itself to actually send a request to this second URL, that is home, because on one tab we are currently waiting for the same URL to get the response. Okay, so we cannot actually call two exact same URLs from two different tabs. We will have to use two different browsers here. Let's copy the URL here, control copy. Okay, now I will press enter here and enter here. You can see that it is currently executing in a preemptive manner, our user level thread manager is actually preempting in between. That's why you can see 2, 1, 3 here in between. So basically we are running two for loops. We are running two for loops side by side. Like for for loop one, it has a thread one, and for for loop two, that is executing for request, for a different request, we have a different thread, that is thread 2. And now these threads are actually behaving in a preemptive manner and are actually running in this way, like thread 1, then thread 2, thread 1, thread 2. Okay, even though on these threads we have an event loop running, on this thread also and on this thread also we have an event loop running on which they have a coroutine registered, which is actually performing a CPU intensive task. But then also our user level thread manager is actually preempting these threads. Our user level thread manager is actually interrupting these threads in between, and this is why these threads are behaving in a preemptive mode, in a preemptive manner. So this will not actually lead to any efficiency here. No increase in efficiency, because we are actually taking the same amount of time if they are run on a single thread also, because overall time will be same only, because in this we are performing a CPU intensive task. Even though they are interrupting in between, then also the overall time will be same only. But in case of, let's say, if I comment this and I use await async io.sleep, and now let's see it will actually result in any advantage or not. Let's say we have to wait for about 20 seconds here. Okay, now let's execute this, hit enter. Async IO is not defined. Okay, we have to import the async IO module first. Import async IO, control save. Now let's hit this URL again, refresh. Now it will wait for about 20 seconds to get the response, and in the meantime we will call this same URL from a different browser tab. So here you can see that now both the browsers are actually waiting for their responses. So what is happening is, this is a thread 2 ID, this is thread 2, and this thread 2 created one more thread, that is 9332. Okay, thread 3 for handling a request first that we have sent from the Google Chrome tab. And now this thread 3 create one more thread to run this async function using async to sync wrapper function. Okay, and on this thread 4 we have an event loop running, right? And now another request comes, so we have one more thread ID, that is 22864 for this thread 4. Now another request comes, and now this thread 2 creates one more thread for handling that request, that let's say it's thread 5, and we have one more thread ID, that is 20812. And corresponding to this request 2 also we have async view. So to run this async view, it created one more thread using async to sync wrapper function, and it is called as T6. And on this thread also we have one event loop running, and the thread ID for this thread 6 is 22496. And now these thread 4 and thread 6 are actually behaving in a preemptive manner. These threads can also behave in a preemptive manner, but this thread 3 and thread 5 is actually waiting for this thread 4 and thread 6 to actually give the response back. Okay, but this thread 1, thread 2, thread 4, thread 6 can actually behave in a preemptive manner itself, because if another request comes in meantime, then all these threads will be interrupted, and this thread 1 will start taking this request and will give it to thread 2, and then thread 2 will actually create one more thread, right? So this is how these threads are actually behaving in a preemptive manner and using the resources efficiently. And also we are using asynchronous programming inside these threads as well. And now if you want to actually perform a database operation inside this async function, then you cannot actually call the database operation that you called inside this synchronous function normally. You cannot actually call that function here directly. That will lead to certain problems, and I will explain you right now what will happen is that, let's say instead of this await async io.sleep, you use the older version of sleep, that is time.sleep. Okay, let's say time.sleep. So now this coroutine cannot understand that when we are using this time dot sleep, it is actually performing a IO based operation. It will not consider that because our event loop cannot understand that this time dot sleep is a IO based operation, because we have a different set of functions to actually perform a IO based operation inside this asynchronous programming, right? That we had already discussed about. Like for requests, we have AIO HTTP, and for file handling, we have AIO files. For sleep, time.sleep, we have async.io.sleep. But for database operation, for DB operation that we perform in synchronous views normally, we don't have any module for this database operation inside this. For this database operation, currently we don't have any module to handle the database operation asynchronously inside Python. Django developers will be launch this feature of handling database operation asynchronously in Django 3.2 version, but currently we are not having this. And currently I am using Django 3.1.7 version. And I will also recommend you to use the latest version of the Django to perform all these operations, because it's possible that due to different version, you may experience a different kind of output here. But in recent versions, like after 3.1, you will expect the same kind of results that I am getting here. You will expect the same, you will get the same kind of results only. So now if I perform a database operation here, let's say I am performing this database operation that we performed earlier inside this, and also we will add one time.sleep, because the result for this database operation, since we have only 10 records in database, we will get the response here at a very fast speed, so we will not be able to actually make two concurrent requests side by side and actually see that how our server is actually behaving. So now if I call this home from two different browser tabs here, let's say refresh here and refresh here. You can see that we got one error here, and that is synchronous only operation. We cannot actually call the database operation directly inside this async view. Okay, this is a Django based error. Django has added this feature of synchronous only operation because we are actually calling a database operation here synchronously inside this async view, and that may lead to a database corruptancy or corruption of data that we have in database. So that's why, to prevent those instances or cases, Django has added this feature. So now it gave us an error of this synchronous operation only. So now if you want to actually perform a database operation inside this async view, that we will handle later on. But now let's actually focus on an IO based operation, or a simple IO based operation if we do not use those asynchronous methods like AIO HTTP or time or async.io.sleep. If we do not use those asynchronous methods, then let's see what will happen. Okay, let's see what will happen. So now I have removed this await async.io.sleep, and I have added this time.sleep. Now I will open two different browsers here, and we will see the actual performance of our server. Okay, we'll actually see how our server is actually handling these requests, and our main motive is to check that our server is actually using the resources efficiently or not. And we will open one timer here. Let's open one clock here. And on this alarm clock, I will set one timer here. We have a timer here. Okay, we will start from this. We will run this clock when we will actually call the same URL, same endpoint from two different browsers. Okay, so now let's open Google Chrome and let's open Microsoft Edge, and let's again call this endpoint, and now start our clock. Okay, then we will see that we are actually using the resources efficiently or not. If we will get result in near about 20 seconds, then it means we are using resources efficiently. But if we get response after 40 seconds, then it means we are not using resources efficiently. We are getting a error here. We are performing a synchronous only operation inside this. Where are we performing our synchronous operation? Okay, we have not saved this. Now let's save this and again try to call those endpoints from two different browsers. And let's refresh our clock here. Now refresh, refresh, and start the clock. Let's wait for the result here. We have got the output for, so see here, we are actually returning the response in 20 seconds for both the request. And how was this possible? This result might be surprising for you, because we use this time.sleep, which is a synchronous method only, inside this async view. Okay, we call this time.sleep inside this async view, but then also we are actually using the resources efficiently, right? How is that possible? Because it was possible because here we are not using two different coroutines right now. We are using two different threads right now. So what is actually happening is, so let's say we have thread 4 here that is running, and on this thread 4 we have a event loop on which there is a coroutine for handling this home request. Okay, so now home function is registered as a coroutine on this thread 4, and now it is executing a task that is time.sleep. And now we have another concurrent request, and that is allocated to this thread 5, let's say, and on this thread 5 we have another coroutine, we have another event loop, and on this event loop we have another coroutine of this home function. So now our event loop is not actually governing the whole process. We have a user level thread manager at higher level, which is actually managing all the threads. So now when this thread 4 is actually executing the task of time.sleep, right, it is performing a time.sleep. So now if we have some more coroutines here, let's say C2, currently we are not having that, but let's say we have C1, C2 and C3. Now these coroutines will actually behave in a cooperative manner, and now this C2 and C1, if we have time.sleep inside this C2 also and time.sleep in this C1 also, then we will not be using the resources efficiently, because then this C2 will actually have to wait for this C1 to actually complete those 20 seconds also. Then only event loop can actually start running this coroutine 2 in that case. But here we are not using these coroutines, we are using two different threads, and now in this different thread we have another event loop on which this coroutine is registered. So now these threads can actually behave in a preemptive manner, and due to interruption in between by user level thread manager, we were actually using the resources efficiently, right? And we were able to return the response in near about 20 seconds only, and not 40 seconds. We were able to return a response in 20 seconds only because of this overlapping of time between two different threads. But now let's say if I create one helper function here, async help function. We have to use a def here, def, and inside this I am using time.sleep 20, and inside this I am using one command async io.gather that we had already discussed about. So it will register two different coroutines inside this that we will mention here, and we will use await, and let's add helper function, help function, parenthesis, and help function. Now let's see, we will be able to return the response in 20 seconds itself, or it will take about 40 seconds. So let's now call the URL from only one browser, because now we are actually calling these two helper function from a single function. So that's why we will call this URL from only one browser here. And let's refresh this clock here. And let's again refresh this page. And let's start our clock. And now let's see, we will be able to actually use the resources efficiently or not. So now you can see that it's now time more than 20 seconds, and till now we have not got the response here. You can see here we have not got the response right now. And here also we have not got the get here, right? So now the response will be given back after about 40 seconds. See, we have got the result here now. We have got the output here in near about 40 seconds. So in this case, we are not actually using the resources efficiently, right? We are not actually using the resources efficiently because this coroutine that we have registered here, it is actually performing a IO based operation, but it is not knowing that I am currently performing a IO based operation. So it will not give the chance to this second coroutine that has also been registered on this event loop. It will not give the chance to this second coroutine and will continue and will block this thread even when it's performing a IO based operation. But now if I use, instead of this time.sleep, if I use async io.sleep to 20 and use await here, control save. Now refresh this clock. Now if I call this URL here again and start play, then you will get the outcome. You will get the output in near about 20 seconds only, because here we are using the asynchronous functions here that are designed specifically for asynchronous programming, and that is async io.sleep. See, now I have got the response in nearly 20 seconds only. So this was possible because we are using this asynchronous programming here. So this is how you have to think about while you are actually coding this multi-threading and asynchronous programming. Okay, I think now you all have understood about this multi-threading and asynchronous programming and how Django is actually handling async views and synchronous views side by side. So now because we got error while we are performing a simple database operation inside this async view, because that is a synchronous operation and we are performing inside this async, so we can actually perform those database operations inside this async as well, like we perform this time.sleep inside this async view also by blocking the whole thread. But then also Django gave us error. So basically this is because Django wants to prevent any type of corruption of data that we have in database. So that's why it gives us error. But in real time, we can actually perform those database operations inside this async as well. But since we don't have any module for performing those tasks asynchronously, so that operation, that database operation will actually block the whole thread, like this time.sleep blocked, right? When we have two different coroutines registered on our event loop. In case of multi-threading, it will pose no problem. But if we are using two different coroutines, then it will lead to not using our resources efficiently. So what we can do is to actually perform database operation efficiently inside this, what we can do is we can use one more command that is known as, we can use one more wrapper function that is known as sync to async. So to call this async function, we use the command async to sync, because at that time we were actually calling an asynchronous function inside a synchronous function, right? And this was creating another thread on this, and on another thread it is actually creating one event loop. Okay, but now if you want to perform a database operation inside this, you will have to use sync to async if you want to perform a database operation inside this async view. So if you want to perform a database operation inside this async view, then you will have to use this, that is known as sync to async wrapper function. Let's use this and actually perform a database operation inside this. Okay, now instead of this await, we will actually perform a database operation inside this by, let's copy this database operation, control x, and let's paste it here. Let's comment this I am not removing the code because I will share the code with you so that you can actually use this code and see the results by yourself. Let's uncomment this now. Student.objects.all. So we are performing a database operation inside this. And here, let's remove this async here right now, because we want to perform this database operation inside a synchronous function, right? And we will call this synchronous helper function inside this async function. So here we will use await sync to async. And for this, we will have to import one thing that is called as from asgiref dot sync import sync to async. And we will call this sync to async wrapper function. And inside this, we will pass the function name help function. Help function. And then you will have to also use parentheses here. After passing the function name here inside this, you will also have to pass this parenthesis, okay? And press control save. And now we will also print thread ID here. Print, copy this, paste here. So that we can actually see how this sync to async is actually performing. Okay. Threading.getNativeID. And here we don't have index, we have help function. Press control save. Now if I refresh this page here, synchronous only operation. Sync to async helper function. If I remove this, then let's call this again. Refresh. And now you can see that we are actually getting the result here. You will have to remove those parentheses inside. And you will have to call those parentheses outside of this helper function. And now we are actually getting the result here. But now you can notice that we are getting a new thread ID again for this helper function that is called as 14260. And this thread ID is common to this call function thread. Okay, you can notice one thing, that this 14260 is actually repeating now. And why it is happening, I will explain you right now. So what happened was, we had thread 1 and thread 2 in starting, right? In starting only we had thread 1 and thread 2. Now request 1 came for this home function, request 1 came and thread 1 take that request and it transferred this request to this thread 2. And now this thread 2 created one more thread, that is thread 3, for handling this request 1. It had the object of WSGI handler, but now it called the call function of this WSGI handler object using this by creating a new thread, and the target function of this thread 3 is basically that call function of this WSGI handler object. So now we have three threads here. Thread 1 we can see only inside this process explorer. As you can see that inside this python.exe we have one main thread, that is 23352, and now we have one more thread, that is 13492. This is thread 2. So we have thread 2 as this thing. Now when we created one new thread, thread 3, for actually handling this request, we created one more thread, that is 14260. So this is thread 3. And now, because this was async function inside this thread 3, we called this async function inside async to sync wrapper. Async to sync. And inside that, we passed this home function. First, we had to check like what this view is. So we checked that using ace coroutine function inside this thread 3. And once it is known, it called that async function using this async to sync wrapper. So it created one more thread, thread 4, and this is thread 4. This is the thread ID for thread 4. And now on this thread 4, we have one event loop running. But now since we cannot perform a database operation inside this async function directly, because it's a kind of a database operation, right? So we have to wrap this helper function inside this sync to async. okay, we cannot actually register this helper function because it's a synchronous function on this event loop. We cannot register as a coroutine on this event loop. We cannot do that. We have to find a new measure here to actually handle a synchronous function inside this event loop. So now what is happening is, as soon as we call the sync to async, it registered one more coroutine here. Now this coroutine, let's say it's a C1. Already we had one coroutine, that is C1 here, for actually handling this home function. We have registered one new coroutine, that is coroutine 2, as soon as we call this sync to async wrapper here. So on this coroutine, we are running this home function, that's a async. And inside this coroutine 1, we actually created one more coroutine, and that will be registered on this event loop. So now these coroutines can actually behave in a cooperative manner. But since this C1 is actually waiting for this C2 to give the response back, because we are using await here, right? We are using await here behind this C2. So this C2, this C1 will actually wait for this C2. But now C2 itself will actually wait for this main thread, because it can't perform a CPU, because the C2 cannot actually perform a database operation, a synchronous function inside the C2. So what it will do is, it will allocate the task to this thread 3. It will allocate the task to this thread 3 here, and this C2 will actually wait for this thread 3 to actually give the response back. Okay, now this operation, database operation, is actually performing on this different thread. So for this event loop, this C2 is actually waiting for a IO device. Okay, it's actually waiting for a IO device to give the response back. So now these C2 and C1 can actually behave in a cooperative manner. But since we have a single process here, so we can only run one thread at a time. So now this thread 3 is executing, but on thread 3, we are performing a database operation. And now since on synchronous view, we can actually perform a database operation normally. So for thread 3, this database operation will be considered as a IO based operation only. So now no thread is working right now, all threads are idle. So if we have more coroutines on this thread 4, then it can actually use cooperative mechanism here. Or if we have some more threads in our thread stack, then they can start executing at that time. So we are using resources efficiently here. But here, and now the C2, when it will get the response back from this thread 3, it will return the response, and then the normal processing will take place. Now this thread 4 will actually return the response to this thread 3, and thread 3 will return the response to this thread 2, and thread 2 will return the response to thread 1, and thread 1 will give back the response to the user. Okay, and now it's done. It might appear very complicated to you, but I am explaining to you because I want to show you how you can use this asynchronous programming in multi-threading concurrently and use the resources efficiently. It's not necessary. Currently, it's of no use to use async view here inside this WSGI. You might be thinking that why you are using this async, right? But I'm telling you, it's of no use right now. But if we switch to ASGI, then this async will give us many advantages. Okay, this async will actually give us a lot of advantages over there. Django, that's why I have returned the application in such a way that our single application can actually handle both kind of views, sync or async. And in this way, they have made easy for us to actually switch from WSGI to ASGI and from ASGI to WSGI. And this async function can actually be beneficial to us when we are performing two types of IO based operation inside one view, because we can't actually perform two types of IO based operation concurrently inside a single synchronous view. If you want to perform two IO based operation concurrently inside a single synchronous view, then you will have to use threading here, multi-threading here. Like suppose here we were earlier performing two helper functions here side by side. If helper function has an IO based operation, then we can actually use overlapping of time here to actually perform those two coroutines side by side in a cooperative manner. So using this await async.io.gather, it was beneficial to us, and we can use this async.io.gather inside this async function only. So in this way, even though we are using WSGI server, this provided us some benefit. But that also we can replicate in simple synchronous view also using multi-threading here. Like suppose if I remove this async here, and now you cannot call these two helper functions side by side, so actually reduce the overall time. We can do that by using threading concept here. Like suppose we are using threading here, so let's say thread one. So now threading dot thread, and inside that target function, target equals to help function. And then thread two, threading dot thread, target help function that I already showed you before, right? And now we will start the thread one, thread one dot start, thread two dot start, and now we will, and then we will join those threads so that these thread one and thread two can actually start executing side by side in a preemptive manner. And if one thread is actually performing an IO based operation, then that at that time thread two can actually start executing and use the resources efficiently, right? And then we can join these threads dot join thread two dot join. So in this way also we can actually perform this task of handling side by side using synchronous view only. We can actually replicate the async and async IO dot gather. We can actually replicate that behavior inside a synchronous view only using threading, right? So these are certain alternatives for you. But if you are using ASGI server, then I will recommend you to use async views in most cases. But I will tell you in what cases you can actually continue using synchronous view only, so that it may not lead to any inefficiency of usage of resources. Okay, I will tell you those cases as well when we will talk about ASGI server. Now let's discuss one more case here. That is, let's say we have a async define home here, and we are, and inside this, let's call this sync to async helper function here. Let's call this. And now let's add a time.sleep here as well, so that we can actually see what is happening. Time.sleep, control save. And let's start the server here. Now let's call this home URL from two different browsers. Let's refresh. So you can see that we have two different threads for handling those requests. So 11788 and 19092, and those threads internally creates one more thread. So 17720 here for 11788, and then 178 for by this 8248. And now what is happening is, like when we are calling this helper function inside the sync to async wrapper function, then it is creating one more thread, and now inside, and it is basically calling the same thread on which our request one was actually allocated, right? So you can see that this 1178 was actually repeated here, 11788, and here 19092, that is 19092. Okay, that is something that I wanted to show you. When we actually use two concurrent requests side by side, then how these threads are actually allocated to the sync to async wrapper function. Now let's add one more case here. Let's remove this async here, and let's make this helper function as async. Now if you want to call this async function inside this synchronous function, that is also possible. That is possible using async to sync. Like our Django application was calling our async function earlier, in the same way we will call this async to sync wrapper function. And for this we have to import from this sync module async to sync. And now we will call this helper function. And now let's remove this database operation, because it cannot be performed inside this sync, because it cannot be performed inside this async function. And now let's remove this time.sleep. Just print this. Okay, I want to just show you that you can actually call one async function inside this synchronous function as well using async to sync wrapper. Async to sync, and now I will pass here help function. And now, and not like this, we have to use this thing. Let's call this function, helper function right now. So now if I refresh this page here, then you can actually run that. I was able to run this async to sync. And now this async to sync will actually start one more thread, and on that thread, it will start a event loop. So what thread 3 was actually allocated this task of request 1 that we sent here. So thread 1, thread 2, thread 3. That's why on thread 3 we printed the 7804, which was repeated here. And this thread 3 is actually creating one more thread, thread 4, for handling this async to sync function here that we have mentioned. And on this thread 4, it will actually start an event loop. And on this event loop, this helper function will be registered as a coroutine and it will start executing. Okay. So this is how it's all working. Now there is one more thing that I want to talk about is that is about middlewares, because our view is not the only function that we define in our views.py. The function corresponding to a particular request, that is not the only function that we are running for a request. Like suppose if request one comes, then if we call a function in this views.py, then it's not only the single function that is actually called while processing this request one. Actually, a lot of more functions are actually performing here. Like in middlewares, the middlewares that we have added in our settings.py, these middleware functions will also executed for this request, right? So we will discuss about this middlewares later on when we have understood about ASGS server as well. So before moving on to the other servers, I want to tell you one more thing, and that is how you can convert a class-based view into a async. Like currently we saw that how you can convert a simple synchronous function into a async function using async command, right? Before defining any function, we use the async and then we define the command to actually start this async function, right? To actually make this function as a coroutine. But now, if you have a class-based view, because you can create a views either in a function-based view or as a class-based view. So now how to add async functionality inside this class-based view as well. So that as soon as we call this class-based view, it will be registered as a coroutine on this event loop on our current thread and start executing that class-based view. So for that, we have to do certain different things, because Django application calls this function-based view in a different manner and class-based view in a different manner. So now let's see how you can do that. I have already written the code for you, but I will explain you everything from scratch. I have made one list view here to print, to get all the students from the database, the 10 records that we have in our database, and then we will render those 10 records to our template. I have also made one template here inside templates folder, which is list.html file, in which I am doing nothing but but I have written a for loop here to actually iterate into the dictionary object that we have passed in this template using context data. So here I have declared this class, and in this I have put normal attributes like template name, model, context object name. But now there is something new that you will see here. I have overrided this method here in this class, that is asView, because this asView will be there in this list view only. When we have inherited this class, this asView was automatically added in our class. But now we have to make certain changes in this asView so that we can actually add async functionality in this class, because this is the most important function and this acts as an interface between a class and the and Django application, so that Django application can actually call this class-based view and start executing that. Because in urls.py, when we declare the URL for this class, then you will notice that we call this class using asView, like views.liststudents, the class name, and then .asView. And you can notice that this asView is basically a class-only method. Class-only method means there is no need to actually create an object for this class to call this function. We can call this asView function directly by using the class name, and that we did here in urls.py. We call this asView function directly by using the class name here, ListStudents. While other functions you can call only using the object of the class. So first you have to instantiate the class, and then you can call those functions using object. So asView work basically is to There is no need to print here because the work of SView is basically to return the view. It basically acts as a callable function. So basically the function of this SView is to return a callable function that takes a request and returns a response. Okay, it takes the request, it acts as an interface between the Django application, which actually calls this class-based view. So this will take the request and then return the response to that Django application. So here we will call this super.sView because first we have to call this normal SView, right? So basically what is happening till now is that we have thread 1 which is listening on this port number 8000. So now the request comes. Let's say request 1 and now it will be passed to this thread 1 and now thread 1 will call thread 2 on which we have our WSJ handler object. And this thread 2 will create one new thread for actually handling this request. And corresponding to this request, we have a class-based view, right? So we have thread 3 here. And now thread 3 will actually call this class-based view here, this asView method here. And this asView, inside this asView, because we called this asView using class name. So currently, we don't have any object for this list students. So inside this asView will create the object of this list students. It will actually create the object of this class that we have called and then it will call certain functions that are necessary for that request according to that request, because if this is a get request, then get method will be called. If it's a post, then post. It depends on how you have configured this view, right? This class-based view. Now we are on this thread 3. So now we want to add async functionality here, so that we can actually start executing this class-based view on a coroutine. Okay, so here we have, so basically like in function-based view, Django uses is coroutine function, and which is a function of async IO. And inside this, it will pass that function, view function, to actually know that it's a synchronous function or asynchronous function. And it's if it's an asynchronous function, and currently on this thread 3, we are not having an event loop, so it will create one more thread and on that thread it will start an event loop, right? But here we are not having a function based view, right? And if it's a synchronous function, then it will continue executing that function inside this thread 3 only. Okay, but since we are not having a function based view here, we cannot check that using this isCoroutine function. So now what Django has done is it has added one more attribute inside this class, this list view, that is coroutine. So we have one more attribute of is coroutine inside this view. So now before actually moving further, let's open this list view in ccbb.co.uk so that we can understand this list view in a more deeper way. So here is the list view in ccbb.co.uk, and inside this asView method you can see that it has defined one function here, define view, in which it is calling other function of the class, that is dispatch. So now after this, so basically in class-based view, functions are called one by one. Like first this asView will be called, asView will call dispatch method inside it. Here we have called dispatch method, and then this dispatch method will call another function inside it. Like here it has called self.http method not allowed. So they will be called one by one like this one. So we have asView, dispatch, and dispatch will call another function according to the request, and then it will call further request till we get the final response. Okay, now you can see that it has inside this view function, it is actually creating the object of this class using class and then setup, and then it is calling dispatch method by passing the request parameters that it has received from the thread that is running this as view. So now there is one object inside this view, right? Inside this view, we have one thing that is called as view. So basically this function object that we have defined here, this view function, this is basically a callable function. Okay, this is the callable function which will actually take the request, and it will act as an actual interface between Django application and the code that we have written here, the custom code that we have written, in which we want the request to be handled. It will act as an interface between this. Okay, and this is the main function this view function. This will take the request and start executing other functions. So inside this view function, we have initiated this class that is list view students that we have created here. And now we are actually creating one attribute for this function that is coroutine. And what we have done here is that corresponding to this is coroutine attribute of this view, we have set this async.io.coroutine.isCoroutine. So when this Django application will actually check that this class-based view we have to run on an event loop or not, so it will check this isCoroutine attribute of this function, that it is a asynchronous function or it's a synchronous function. So that's why we have used this attribute of isCoroutine of a function, because function itself is an object. It's kind of an object, right? And inside that, we have what we have done is we have placed this value, that is asyncio.coroutine.isCoroutine. So this is how we actually made this class-based view or this view function as a async function. So now when Django application will actually see that it's an async function, it will call this function using async to sync, because on current thread it is not having any event loop. So now we have thread 3. So now thread 3 will create another thread 4, and on this thread 4 it will start running one event loop, and in this way we can start running this function. And now this inside this async function that we have defined here inside this callable function, what it will do is it will run all the statements, it will call all those functions one by one inside that in a sequential manner, because in those functions we are not actually performing a database operation or any IO based operation, that we will perform on our own. And one thing that I want to mention is that, like, we have converted this view into a async view, but now we have to take care of database operation by ourselves, because if we do not modify that database operation by ourselves, then it will give us error that synchronous only operation is not allowed inside async, because that is not handled by Django application right now. So what I have done is I have made one more function here, that is async define get. Now let's say if I remove this async here, remove this here, all the things, and let's add students equals to student dot objects dot all. Okay. Now if I refresh this page here, like students here, I had done this earlier because I want to check that it's working or not. Okay. Now if I refresh this page here, you will get one error, that is synchronous only operation, because now this get method will also call normally inside the parent async function, and inside this parent async function we cannot actually call this database operation directly. Okay, we cannot call this, right? So we have to find a measure here to find to actually call this database operation. So we can do that using a wrapper function that is called as sync to async, because we have to actually call this synchronous function inside a async function, right? So we have to call this using sync to async wrapper function. So now let's remove this and let's uncomment this and let's add async here, control save. So here I have taken one more example for you so that we can understand about this async class based view in a more better way and understand about these coroutines as well in Python. So before we actually see this example, which is exactly working in a similar way as our class based view works, let's first talk about this thing, like in how many ways you can create a coroutine. So first way is like async define function. Okay, you can define you can create a coroutine using async define function. Okay, as soon as you declare a function using async, it will be treated as a coroutine. So now if you call this function, like suppose if I call this function inside anything, now if I do not use await here, now if I call this function, like make a real call by using parentheses here, then it will return something in the form of coroutine of type, like this function call, the output returned by this function, then it will give me something as class coroutine. So now this function was a coroutine, right? But when we are actually making a call to this function without using await, it is giving us something in the form of this class coroutine. So now this coroutine can have two meanings. One is when we create any function using async, then that function is called as coroutine. And if we really call that function using parentheses, then it returns the output of something called as class coroutine. Suppose I have made one async function, let's say async defined function, and inside this I am returning a HTTP response. Okay, now if I call this function like function, so now this function, instead of giving a response of HTTP response, it first gives a response in the form of coroutine of type class coroutine. Okay, now if we really want to parse this HTTP response from this coroutine object that is returned by this function, then it can be retrieved using await here. Like if I use await here, await, then call this function, and now the output of this whole will be HTTP response. So this function gave us the object of coroutine here, but when we actually parse this object using await, then we were able to actually extract that HTTP response that was given by this async function of coroutine. Okay, but this class coroutine that we are getting here, it's the output that is returned by this function one by its alone when we call this function actually. Okay, so this is how coroutines actually work. Now there is one more way in which you can create a coroutine here. Like suppose you create one function based view, a normal synchronous function based view. Now if you wrap this function inside the sync to async wrapper, then you can call this function using await as well. Await and function. Now this function will also return one object output that is of coroutine type, class coroutine. Okay, and with await we can parse the output. So what is actually happening in this, when we wrap this function inside the sync to async, this function itself is not a coroutine function. Okay, this function is not itself a coroutine function. What is happening here is it created one more coroutine here, one more function that is a coroutine function that will be registered on the current event loop. And now one more thread is created on which this helper function, on which this function with name func will be called here. This will run here, and this coroutine with another name will wait for the response from this function which is running on the another thread. So it is creating one new coroutine function here. Okay, and here that we are waiting for this function, so this will return the response that is returned by this coroutine. So the output will be from this coroutine function, and this output that we have received here is of type class coroutine. And to actually parse the result from this coroutine function, we have to use await here. So now there are two things. One is coroutine function, and the output that is returned by this coroutine function, and that is of class coroutine type. Okay, this is the output. And there is one more mechanism to create one async function, that is using isCoroutine. And this is the mechanism that is used by our class-based view, because here we are not using any functions here. Because here we are not using functions directly, we are making a class here in which we are defining various functions, right? So we have to use some another measure. Now suppose you create one function here that is define function and which returns a response, right? So inside this function too, in which you want to make this function async and call that function, you have to use this measure. Like first you will parse the object of this function using a equals to func, and we are not actually making a call to this function using parentheses here. Okay, you can see there are no parentheses here. So we are only parsing the object of this function here. And then what we are doing is we are adding one new attribute of this function, that is a dot underscore isCoroutine, and then equals to async io dot coroutines dot isCoroutine. And in this way, we are making this function as a coroutine function. But this cannot be called as a coroutine function here, okay? It is not exactly a coroutine function. So this func will not actually behave as a coroutine function that we defined here as async defined function. It will not ex exactly behave in similar manner. What it does is it will add one more attribute here, and now if we check this function that it's a coroutine function or not using async io dot is coroutine function, then it will say that it's a coroutine function. It will give us true. Yes, it's a coroutine function. It will say that. But when we actually get the response by calling this function, like suppose I make a call here. So here, if we call this function, it will not work. It will give an error here. Because this A, that is function object, when we are actually calling this function using parentheses, then this function will not give us the object of type coroutine, of class coroutine that we were getting earlier when we were calling this function of async. So here we will not get the output of class coroutine here. We will not get that. We will get a simple type of response that we are returning here. Suppose we are returning a HTTP response, then the type of that response or output will be HTTP response. And if we are returning a integer response, then it will be of type integer. And if it's on string, then it will be of string type. So if we use await here, because this async to sync internally uses await only, okay, we can use await or async to sync to convert or parse the actual object that is returned by this function, by these coroutine functions, okay? Because in starting, when they return something, that will be of type coroutine only. So when we use await here or async to sync A here, let's say this one. So now this A will give us directly the response in the form of str or integer or HTTP response that we will return here, okay? It will directly return the response in this form. So now this await, when used directly with this, it will give us error because this await demands a type of object that is of coroutine class. Like as we mentioned here, class coroutine, it demands something of class coroutine, and then it will convert that object response into this string or integer or HTTP response. This is how it works. Okay. So now this will not work directly here. We will have to use something in define function to return something that is returning a coroutine object as a response. So what we are doing here, we are doing that using this thing. So now let's actually talk about this. And it is using some mechanism here through which we can actually get a coroutine object response. Okay, so what is happening here? Like suppose in starting, I call this as view, and you can notice here, I have made three function here. One is as view, dispatch and get. Get is a basic, get basically is a main handler function for request, because currently we were using a list view. So for that, we make a get request, and for handling that get request, we make a function that is async define get. And then we have two more functions. One is as view and one is dispatch, and dispatch is also a very important function. Okay, so this as view, because if I open this ccb.co.uk, inside this as view, it creates one view function. And so basically what happens is, first we define inside url.py, like if I open this url.py, you can notice that we first define that we call this function here, that is as view here directly here. With parenthesis, we are actually calling this as view function here, so that this as view will return one function of view that we want, and this view will actually be treated as a async function, because that is a thing what we were doing earlier, right? We are making this view object function as a coroutine function, but that coroutine function will not behave exactly in the similar way as this async define function will work that we discussed right now, right? Here inside this, you can see that we saw this thing only, right? So now instead of using this view function that is returned by this as view, I directly treated this as view as a view function. Okay. Now what I'm doing is I am parsing this view function as an object, like a equals to as view. And then I am making this as view function as a coroutine using this a dot underscore is coroutine. So that when Django will check that it's a coroutine function or not, then it will return a true. Because here we are using this if async io dot is coroutine function a. So it will return a true here. And if it's a true, we can call this coroutine function using this async to sync. But here, this will give error if we follow the same mechanism that we were following here. Okay, because here we are actually calling this sync view and we are directly returning a response here, a simple response here. So it will give an error here. What we are doing here is that we have one normal synchronous view function as view, and if I directly return a response here, then when this async to sync will try to parse the exact object response that it has returned here, then it will give us error because async to sync will demand for something of class coroutine. But here, because here we are using this type of conversion, it will return a normal response here. Like if it's a string, then string. If it's an integer, then integer. Or if it's a HTTP response, then it's a HTTP response, right? But we want something that returns a object of class coroutine. So that's why we made this main handler function as async. And the reason for that is that this get function, because it's async, and we call inside this as view, we call dispatch function, which itself is a synchronous function, right? And inside this dispatch, we call this function that is get. Inside this function, we call the get function that is the main handler function for request. So now we have made this async function. Now when this get function will return a response here, it will return a response in the form of class coroutine because it's a async function, right? And this async function is something that we talked about right now. It will return the response in the form of class coroutine. And dispatch was called inside this as view using return dispatch. And dispatch will be returned here, class coroutine. So this was something that we want, right? So now when this async to sync will try to parse the exact object from this class coroutine, then it will be able to parse the exact type of response that was returned here. Like suppose we are returning here a string object, then it will return a string response. So now let's run this code and see what are the results that we are getting here. So now if I press a play button here, then you can see that we call this start function here, and the start function, inside the start function, we print async io.isCoroutine function a, because we are converting this a to isCoroutine function using dot underscore isCoroutine, and that's why we got a true here, because this is only we want, right? We wanted to convert this as view function to async so that Django application can see that the class-based view is a synchronous function or a async function, okay? And then it will call that function accordingly. So now you can see that we are getting a true here, and we got a true here, right? So this will follow this path. Then we were calling this result equals to async to sync a, and we actually call this function that is as view. And inside this as view, we got one error here because we are trying to call this dispatch function, that is a function that is here, in which we are actually returning a get function here, and this get function is a async function, right? We are directly calling this function inside this. We are not returning this function. We are actually calling this function dispatch, which is actually returning a coroutine object. That's why we got error here. That is, coroutine get was never awaited because this get function is a real coroutine function, right? And this will return an object of type class coroutine. So we have to use await here to parse the object of that. That's why we got an error here. So we cannot actually call this function that is defined with async directly inside this. What we can do is we can return this dispatch so that wherever we are calling this as view, because we are calling this as view using async to sync. Okay, we are calling this as view using async to sync. And inside this, we are calling this function as view, right? So this as view will return the object of that was returned by this get function. And this get function is actually returning a object response of class coroutine. And that is something that we want here, right? We want this thing only. So that this async to sync can actually convert this coroutine to a normal object response that we are trying to give here. That is here, like here we are trying to get the done, that is a string response. So this async to sync will convert that class coroutine object to this class string. That's why we were able to actually run the class-based view successfully inside this. And that's why it was important to convert the main handler function to async. We have to make one function as an async so that we can actually parse the object from that using async to sync or await. if we are converting that function using underscore is coroutine. Okay, so this was the mechanism that we have to follow, and that's why it will not work here. We have to use our async function here, and we have to call that async function inside this. Not call that function, we have to return. It's very important that we have to return our dispatch, right? So let's comment this. Let's control save. And now if I run this, we will not get any warning here. We will get true and done because we are actually printing the result here. So these are three ways in which you can create coroutines, right? Now if you want to see like what is the type of A, let's say we have to use print. Control save. Let's run this. Then you can see that it's currently in function state only. It's of class function. Even though we have and let's again print this, print type A, and let's also print type A and actually call that function so that we can know what is the type of object that is returned by this function, because here we are actually making a call and the type will check the object response that was given by this function A. And now if I refresh here, you can see here that first of all, we have not used await here. That's why we are getting a warning here. Okay. So now you can see that we got class function. So basically this A is a function only, right? Before we actually call this function, this will be treated as a function only. But and after we have made this coroutine also, then also we got a class function here, right? It will be of class function only, but we call this function as a coroutine. Even if we check the type of this dispatch method, like suppose if I check print type of this function, that is get, which is a async function. Let's check that. And we are not actually making a call to that function right now. Now if I press play here, now you can see that for this also we are getting a class function here, even though it's a async function and we have made this a coroutine, but then also it will be of class function only, because here we are calling this async define get function as a coroutine. So it's a coroutine function, but it's a type of class function only. But when we will actually call that function, get function, and it will return our object response, then this object will be of type coroutine. That will be of type class coroutine, not of class function. Okay. So basically there are two entities here. One is coroutine function and one is object that is returned by this function, and that is of type class coroutine. Okay, two entities are there. And one more thing that you can check here is that, like, when I do this print type A, then it gave us a coroutine here, because we are actually calling this dispatch, which is calling this get function, and get function is returning a object response of class coroutine. But if I press comment this, let's comment this and let's uncomment this one. And now if I do print type get, and let's actually make a function call here. And now if I press a play here, then you can see that in starting we got class function for this get, and then we did type get and make a call, actual call to this function. Then we got one class coroutine here, which is good. And now when we print type A, then we got function here. Okay. And then again for type A, we got one function here. But here, if I make a call to this A, which we made a coroutine function using underscore is coroutine, then also I got a class str object response, not a coroutine object, right? So this was the thing that we want to remove here. And that's why we returned a async function here. That's why we did this. That's why we made this get function, a handler function as get, because these are the main functions that will be called in a sequence, like first as view, then dispatch, then get. And inside these three main functions, there can be some more functions that can be called internally. Like if I see here in ccview.co.uk, you can see some more function here, right? So basically you can call these synchronous functions inside any of these functions by directly calling those functions, right? Because they are performing a CPU intensive task only. So it will not create any problem. But if you are performing any IO based operation inside this get, then you will have to use asynchronous programming, or you will have to use a sync to async to make a database operation, right? That's why earlier we made a handler function. Like here, we made a handler function inside this views.py. Inside this, we made one helper function and we wrapped that function inside the sync to async to perform a database operation. Because currently in Python, we don't have a asynchronous method to call to make a database operation, right? So inside this async function, you can call those function like, suppose if you want to call this function, let's say getPaginator. So you can call that function directly by getPaginator. But if PageNator is performing some IO based operation, then you will have to do certain things. Like you will have to wrap this function inside a sync to async to call that function, right? So that one more thread is created here on which this synchronous function will be run, so that we do not degrade resources here. Because if you are performing an IO based operation and if you are not using sync to async, then first of all, we will get one synchronous only operation error. But if you remove that error using async unsafe in settings.py, then you will degrade the resources here, because that will block the whole thread. Even though you are performing a IO based operation, then also you will block the whole thread. Okay. So this was something that I want to tell you, like how this class based view is working. Now there is one more thing that I want to tell you, is that is this one. So this is, let's remove this because it is already added inside this, that is commented here. Now let's uncomment this. And here what I am doing is I am actually checking all types of three cases that we discussed here. Three cases that we discussed here, we are checking all that thing in here. And let's also create one more function, that is this one. Let's create one sync to async to check how it is working and what type of response it is giving back. Now if I, and this is basically for a real async function that is defined using async define function, because we have defined this get function using async define get, right? Let's press control save here. Now if I run this, okay, let's comment this, let's run this. So now you can see that when we run this command type get, then we got class function, because it's a function only, because in starting when we are not making a call, then it's a coroutine function. Then we call this async io.scoroutine function get, because we have defined using async here. That's why it will return a true here. That's why we got a true here. And then we actually check the type of this get, but we are not awaiting here. That's why it gave us warning here. But the object response that is given by this get function is of class coroutine type, right? And then we are actually using this sync to async function so that we can understand how it's working. So now when we did this print type help, then it gave us this thing, class asgiref.sync.sync to async, because now this help function is not a kind of a function right now. It is basically converted to a type that is called as asgiref.sync.sync to async, because we have wrapped this helper function inside the sync to async. Okay. Now, if we call this async.io.scoroutine function, then it will give us true here, because we have wrapped this inside the sync to async. And then if I do print type help and we actually make a call to this function, then also we are getting a class coroutine. Because what is happening here, like when we wrap this function inside the sync to async, it will create one coroutine here and coroutine function and add this inside this event loop. And that function name will be this one, sync to async call. So that coroutine function will be added inside this event loop, this one. And now it will wait for another thread on which this help function will run. Okay, on this help function will run synchronously, and now it will wait for this new thread to give the response back. And when it will receive the response here, then this sync to async call coroutine will actually give the response in the form of class coroutine. And that's why we got here class coroutine here. And we will have to use await here to actually convert this coroutine object into a type of response that we are sending here. Here we are sending a string response. So when we use await, then this will give us a string object response. And other is same that we discussed earlier, that is using is coroutine. So this is the mechanism that is being followed in this class-based view to convert this class-based view to a async view. And here we are actually converting this class-based view to async. So whether it's a WSGI server or whether it's a ASGI server, it will be treated as a async function only. So on WSGI server, if someone wants to call this as view method of this class-based view, then it will have to use async to sync. And if you are on ASGI server, then it can directly run as a coroutine on its event loop. And we will talk about this ASGI server later on. But now we have converted this class-based view into a async type. And I will also give the code file for this so that you can actually understand what is happening here by performing all this task by yourself. So in the similar manner, this list view that we talked about earlier is following the same mechanism that we are following here, that we followed here. It is following the same mechanism to convert this class-based view into a async type. Okay. And that's why we used a async define get here, because it's necessary to use this async here, because this get function will be treated as a main request handler function, and which will be called inside this as view. And there should be one async function so that we can actually get the object response of type class coroutine, which can be converted by this async to sync to a real response that was given by this get function here. So here we are returning a string object, but here inside this main view, we are actually returning the, but inside this get function of main list view, we are actually returning a template here. Okay, we are actually returning a template here. So that's why it's important. And also if I do async here, like suppose if I convert this as view as async here, then also it will give us error here. Like suppose if I make this async here, so now you will have to do this because there is no need to convert this async function once again to a coroutine function because it's already a coroutine function, right? So now comment this, control save. And now if I press play here, then you can see here I am getting an error here. Coroutine get was never awaited here. This was because this get returned a object of class coroutine, right? And inside this as view, we call this dispatch. So this again returned one object of class coroutine. And inside this, we have one more object of class coroutine that was returned by this get. So now when we wrap this when we call this function using async to sync, so it will convert this coroutine function. So it will cancel out, but inside this, it will again see that it's a coroutine. So that's why we got our error here. We were not actually able to convert this coroutine object response to this response that we are giving here. Like here we are giving a string response. So we were not actually able to extract that, because we are again getting a coroutine. So now we have understood about this class-based view function as well. And it was very important to see this case that we discussed right now here to actually understand about the return type of this coroutine functions that we were talking about. Okay, because this coroutine function actually gives the response in the form of class coroutine that needs to be converted to a real response by using await here. So that's why Python has designed the mechanism in such a way that we have to use await here to actually get the response. Or if you do not want to wait for the response from that, then you will have to call that function using loop.createTask. We cannot directly call this function because currently it has to wait or continue executing the commands that are defined after this command or instruction. So that's why it gave us a warning here. Now let's actually call this list view from browser here to see how it's working. So now let's call this endpoint and hit enter here. So now we are getting a response like this. So here we have thread 1, which is making a socket connection. Then we have thread 2, and thread 2 thread ID is this one, 20684. And this thread basically contains the object of WSGI handler. And when we call this list students.asView, so that asView that we have defined in urls.py will return a view method. And this view is basically a coroutine function because we have used a mechanism of view.isCoroutine here That is the third mechanism that we used. So now it will be converted to a coroutine function. But now this coroutine function is a little bit different than that function that we have defined as async define. Because whatever you return inside this async define function using return response, then it will return the object response of class coroutine object type. But now if we call this view coroutine function using async to sync, because Django will see that view function is coroutine function, so it will call that view function using async to sync. But if we do not use async define get here, async define get here, then it will return a normal HTTP response, and that is not what async to sync demand. Because this async to sync demand object response of class coroutine, so that it can actually parse the exact object from that class coroutine object response. And now this thread 2 will create one more thread for handling this request. So that thread ID is 13588. But now since it's an async SU function, so that's why it will create one more thread, that is thread 4. And on this thread 4, it will create one event loop. And on that event loop, it will register one coroutine function, that is a view function that is returned by as view. So this view will be registered as a coroutine function, will be added inside this event loop as a coroutine function. And now this view will be called and view will start running. And inside this view, a dispatch function will be called, dispatch function. And dispatch function will call this get function that we have defined here. Right? And on thread 4, that's why we got the thread ID of 11236. And when this get function will be called, we'll call this handler function. And inside this get function, it will call one more function, that is await self.getData, and which is wrapped inside this sync to async. So for sync to async, it will again allocate a task to this thread 3. By creating one more coroutine, it will allocate a task to this thread 3 because it's a synchronous operation. So it will be performed on this thread which do not has an event loop. So that's why we got again the thread ID of 13588 inside this get data. So it will wait for the response from this thread 3. And once it has got the response here, then other remaining instructions of this get will be performed and a response will be given back. And here inside this get, we are returning a template response here. And this view function will be called using async to sync. But now since we are using our async here, so that's why this will return a response of class coroutine. And then this async to sync will parse the exact object response of this template view from that class coroutine object and will finally return the response back to the user by this thread one. So this is how it's all working. And you can see one change here that we have received here, and that is this one. We are getting a false here for when we checked here if async.isCoroutine function self.getData, which we have wrapped inside the sync to async, we are getting a false here. So this coroutine function is basically considering as a normal synchronous function, not a coroutine function, because here getData is not of type this thing that we received in this thing. We got the type of that function as asjref.sync.sync to async. Inside this, when we checked for this help function type help, then we got something asjref.sync.sync to async. But inside this, we are getting something functools.partial, because here getData is not the function, it's basically defined inside a class. So basically this getData is a method. Because it is defined inside a class, it's not a function, and it is called as a method, because function inside a class are called as method, right? So that's why it is being treated like this. But when we actually call this using await here, it will be treated normally as this function is treated inside this. When we call this help function, so it will be treated in that way only. So that is nothing to worry about. So this is how it's all working. I wanted to discuss about how to change this class-based view to async, because resources are very less regarding this on internet, because some people use class-based view only and some use a combination of function-based view and class-based view. So this needs to be covered, right? Because when we talk about ASJS server, then it might be possible that in some cases you want to convert your synchronous class-based view to a async class-based view, right? That's why I've talked about this also. And in this way, we also get a chance to understand about these coroutines. Like when we call a coroutine function, then what it will return. And we also talked about different types of ways to create a coroutine function and how this coroutine function that we defined, that we made using dot underscore is coroutine, how this is different from this async defined function. So now you must be thinking like, I have explained you a lot of things here, right? So you must be confused like when to use which type of view and when to use which type of view. So I will tell you my recommendation, like what you can use in what scenario, what type of views, like you have to use async views in this scenario, or you have to use sync view in this scenario, or you have to use sync to async adapter function or async to sync wrapper function. I will explain you that after we have gone through all the servers that I have listed for you, like ASGA server as well, so that we can actually understand in what scenario what views are best for you, right? But those who wanted to know now only, I will give you one brief tip which you can use right now. So if you are using a WSGA server only and you have nothing to do about ASGA server, like you don't have to, like you don't want to use WebSockets in your Django project or use HTTP 2.0 protocol, then you can directly use these simple synchronous views only. There's no need to use this async views inside this WSGA server. But I will recommend you in one case in which you can actually use async function, and that is when you are actually performing two IO based operation corresponding to a single view. Like one request comes, and for this request one only, you have to perform more than a single, more than one IO based operation. So if you want to perform two IO based operation or more than that corresponding to a single request, then you can use this async function, so that you can use this async.io.gather function of async IO module to run two IO based operations side by side. So if one coroutine is actually waiting for the response from the IO device, then other coroutine can actually start executing. Because here if you use threading concept, then it will create two threads, so it will create some extra overhead. You can also do that using this threads here, but that will create some more internal threads and that will lead to extra overhead. So what should be the main motive for you inside this WSGA server is that you have to perform, you have to complete that task using minimum number of threads, okay, using by creating minimum number of threads. Minimum number of threads, you have to complete that task. So this should be the main motive. So this you can achieve by using coroutines, right? So this is one thing that I want to tell you. Because if you use async function inside this WSGA server, then, and you are not actually performing two IO based operation, then this async view will not give any advantage to you, but it may cause some trouble only. Because for calling this async view function, Django application has to call one wrapper function, that is async to sync, which will create one more thread only. Okay, it will create one more thread on which it will actually start a event loop, right? So I will not recommend at all if you are not concerned with ASGA server or you don't want to use WebSockets in your Django project, it's a simple basic project, then I will recommend you to use only this sync functions only, synchronous functions only, right? But in one case that I told you right now, if you want to perform two IO based operations or more than that, you can actually use this async function and use this async io.gather function to actually perform those IO based operations side by side instead of using multi-threading concept here. Because for each IO based operation, then it will create a new thread and that will create some extra overhead. So that is not recommended. Now let's move to another server, that is this one. So now we will discuss about this GUnicorn WSGA server, and this is a WSGA server which is written in Python itself, and this server has the capability to actually handle the real traffic, and it's safe from security point of view and can handle multiple concurrent requests side by side. Because when we were using the development server of Django, we are actually using only one Python process. Okay, we were only using one Python process, and inside that we were using threads one thread for listening on the port, and then one thread to actually hold the object of WSJ handler. But here, inside this GUnicorn WSJ server, we can actually use multi-processing mechanism along with multi-threading. So now you can take advantage of multi-processes also along with multi-threads. So this is the advantage of this GUnicorn. We can start multiple workers, and each worker will be allocated separate resources. So for kernel, all these workers, like this is a worker 1, worker 2, worker 3. You can also create some more workers here, but it's generally recommended that you choose number of workers as equal to number of CPUs, CPU cores, so that we can use all the cores of CPU at a single point of time. But that's not possible actually, because there will be some internal processes also that will be running on your system. But still, you can also make this 4, 5, but appropriate number of workers will be 4. Okay, I will recommend you to use 4 workers. Now, these separate workers will be treated as a separate process by this kernel, because this kernel will allocate a separate PCB for this process 1, separate PCB for this worker 2, and separate PCB and other resources for this process 3. And each process will have its own CPython interpreter. Okay, it will have its own CPython interpreter, and this also, so that we can actually run all these processes side by side on different CPU cores in a real parallel mode. Now this part is same as we discussed earlier in our development WSGH server of Django. So this part is exactly same that we discussed earlier, but there is some more things here that is a main process. So now here we have divided the work of main process. Our main process, on this main process, there will be one thread which is actually listening on the port. Okay. And now these workers will actually create new threads for each request that this main process will actually forward to them. So now suppose if request 1 comes, so now it will see that all the workers are free. So now this main process will actually forward this request to worker 1. And now this worker 1 will actually create one separate thread for handling this request 1. So let's say thread 1. And now if request 2 comes, then it will forward the request 2 to worker 2. And now it will create one more thread for handling this request. Let's say thread 1 for this worker. And another request comes, request 3, it will be forwarded to this worker. And it will handle in the same manner like other workers. Now if request 4 comes, then it can forward this request 4 to any of the workers. So now it can forward this to this worker. So let's say it has forwarded this request 4 to this worker 1. So now it will create one more thread here, because this worker can internally use multi-threading concept, right? It can use multi-threading concept for handling all the requests. Let's say thread 1, thread 2. These threads will be called as request handling threads. And you can mention that in starting only, like when you are starting this GUnicorn server, you can mention that workers equals to 4 and threads equals to 4. So each worker can actually create 4 threads at max for these requests. So at a single time, this single worker can actually handle 4 requests concurrently. But as you know, it can't run multiple threads side by side in a real parallel mode. As these workers are working, it is not possible. You know, for a single worker, it can actually run a single thread at a single point of time. And this worker can have more internal threads as well, but those threads are not counted inside this request handling threads, right? So these request handling threads can be 4 at max, but it can have a lot of internal threads as well for performing any background task or that we are creating internally inside views.py file, or anywhere inside our Django application, using sync to async adapter, async to sync adapter, or using threading concept, anything. You can create a lot of internal threads inside this. Okay. So now we have a good understanding about this WSJ server.
That's it for this video. I hope you have liked this video. And if you did, please press that like button and do subscribe to my channel. And if you have watched this complete video and have understood every concept that has been discussed in this video, then you have come up one step closer to master programming world. Because in this video, I have tried to cover everything about WSGS server, about multi-threading, about asynchronous programming, everything. And in the next video, we'll talk about Node.js server and ASJS server, and we will actually make Django behave as Node.js, and we'll compare different kinds of servers like ASJS server, Node.js server, Junicorn, Ubicon, and Daphne. Everything will be covered in the next video. So stay tuned, stay connected. See you in next video.